Episode 7, Straycast Outdoor Cartoon Television. It's happening now live from Hammond, Indiana, in the Bruce Berggren Studios. I am Pat Renwick, and as usual, we have an amazing, bass-tacular show worked up for you today. I mean, nothing but the bass. Nothing but bass wishes for everyone.
Bass? Oh,
yes.
Bass regards.
Bass regards. Bass-o-matic. Put it in the blender. The whole dang thing. Hey, man, we got a giant, giant show worked up. It's just for you, the viewer, the listener.
Huge.
All you bass fans out there.
And hey, I want to tell
you. We got
you.
Kevin Pink, K Short. KPink, Kevin Short, coming here, or not coming here, but coming here via Skype through technology that we can actually video talk with this guy. Kevin Short, he's coming on today. Everybody knows KPink, man. Everybody knows KPink. He's a superstar. We got some stalwarts. We got some stalwarts in the works here. Eric Stark, who is Tony Stark's cousin, who is Iron Man.
I thought it was younger brother.
Yeah, no, it's his cousin. It's his cousin. It's Iron Man.
Don't be afraid of that mic there, Dale.
I think it's his nephew.
It's his nephew? I thought you were cousins. But anyway, you know, I see that thing glowing
like
in your chest.
Brother.
I'm not sure exactly what that is. And Nick Langton, they're stalwarts today. They're stalwarts. Hey.
You didn't call them a Hogwart. They should feel honored.
Well, the Hogwart part comes
it's funny,
later.
I was actually at the doctor and had one of those burned off.
You did. I know. I heard that about you.
Yeah,
but
I
thank
screamed.
Thank God you're better now.
Hogwart or a stalwart?
Thank God you're better.
Both. They were in a very sensitive place.
Hey, sitting to my right, he's seen a million faces, and he's rocked them all. He's a cowboy on the steel horse he rides. He's the viceroy of Herbage. He's the outdoor columnist for the Chicago Sometimes. I call him my buddy Dale. Dale Bowman, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen. That's Dale Bowman right there.
Yeah.
That's Dale Bowman. Over here to my left, we have S. Cinco. Yes, S. Cinco. He's the Southside Sockeye Salmon Samurai.
I thought the boat
yes.
sprung
That's
a leak.
That's the Southside Sockeye Salmon Samurai.
I'm a man of many names.
Yeah, you know, he catches sockeye salmon.
Bobby, repeat that for me, please.
How's your bilge pump?
I cannot repeat that. I'm
Southside Sockeye Salmon Samurai.
That's
four. I don't even think I've caught a
Southside
sockeye.
Southside's one word. It's
no,
a compound word. We learned that in third grade.
Just produce less chatter, more splatter.
Less chatter, more splatter.
Southside sockeye is some kind of crazy salmon from Australia.
Just come on over here and I'll show you.
It's from Australia. It's from Australia. And you guys know that this guy right here, he is the mastermind behind the tightrope jig. Him and JP Huff and stuff.
That's right.
This is Ryan Popcorn Whitaker. Yes! That's Ryan Popcorn Whitaker. You guys are in the same room with Ryan Popcorn Whitaker. Do you believe that?
I feel blessed just to breathe the same air that he's exhaling.
Do you believe that? Hey, Bobby B., what's in the box today? What do you got going on Bobby's in the box and on the water and all around the place?
Well, Jeff Miller stocked up the lunchbox today.
Jeff Miller!
Whoa. He's releasing all his Lake Michigan secrets
today. Did he put a banana in there?
I hope so.
We're going to talk about bananas.
Hungry.
We're going to talk about
bananas.
He
also got me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and cut the crust off.
How about an oatmeal cream pie?
Hey, and Ryan Whitaker.
Snack pack.
Who's your hammer today?
The hammer today is also coming outside of the box.
Yes.
It's Jeff Miller as
what?
Well.
The irony of this all. We're hurting for guests apparently already in show seven.
No.
Just kidding. Jeff Miller is a hammer. He's the death of a hammer. And Mr. Bowman, what's in Bowman outside today?
Bowman outside, we're going to start off with the Browns being stocked, and then we're going to wander around.
The Cleveland Browns.
No, God, no.
James Brown, the godfather of bass.
Candy they just put
get
in
up,
Lake
get on
Wait,
up.
James Brown,
get up now, get on
James
up.
Brown
no, James Brown, the godfather, so get on up.
Can I do it?
Like a chain down, get on up. How?
Good God. How does that work?
That one.
I have had it.
That's the one we're talking about.
Wow! Oh, sorry.
That was Larry again. Hey,
hanging
so
out the cab box.
Dale. Tell us what else is happening.
Well, I'm interested to get Eric and Nick on because I found that their story is interesting on a couple levels. One is how they were able to bring bass fishing into their high school, Glenbard North.
I wish there was bass fishing when I was in high school.
Not Eric's.
Yeah.
You know, don't you wish there was bass fishing when we were in high school?
I probably would have tried a little harder.
We wouldn't have hung out in the parking lot.
School.
Yeah, exactly.
I wouldn't have been staring out the window every day.
Instead of skipping school to go fishing, we could have went fishing.
I would have been hanging out at the middle school.
Yeah, you still do hang out at the middle school.
No.
Wait a minute now. Hey now.
Standards and practices.
Anyway, hey. First of all, here, you know, we got a bonanza going on as far as sponsorship goes. We're bringing only quality products. First of all, you know about
really little Joe
the tightrope jigs. Okay, the tightrope jigs, man. That is the premier finesse jig of the Great Lakes, of the Midwest. The original. Do not be fooled by the imitations. The tightrope jig is the dizzle. All right. Also, Stank X Bait Company, handmade finesse baits, available on Tackle Warehouse and available on StankXBaitCo.com. Right. PH Custom Lures, the finest handcrafted balsa lures in the continent, country, global, continental United States, and Istanbul. Everywhere.
You sure they got Kazakhstan.
Yes, it's not Constantinople. It's Istanbul. And we are proud to bring to the Stray Cast Ship of Fools Dem Jigs. John DeMay and Dem Jigs. Now, that jig is a power jig. You can flip, swim, drag, foam, ching, stroke, boom. That's the jig.
That's your big boy.
Dem Jigs, brand new this week. check them out at demjigs.com and get yourself some jigs. Hey, I want to say a special shout out to our buddy who watches Stray Cast. Little 4-year-old Nolan Higgins is watching out right there. Hey, Larry, let's call it. That's Nolan Higgins.
Hey, Nolan.
Yeah. Everybody, give it up for no-no. That's no-no. Hey, let's call somebody up right now, Larry.
Is it time?
Yeah, let's call somebody
it's time.
Up. Yeah.
Let's see here.
Let's
find
call him up.
Phone.
Who are we calling?
Okay.
Hey, hold on.
Hello. One of my favorite punk songs is I Hear the Telephone Ring.
Hello.
Him.
Wait.
Hello. Is this Batman?
Robin. Is this Robin?
What, could you put Batman on the phone, please?
No, this is Batman. Is this Robin? I'm in the Batcave. The feedback is a little distracting.
No, Robin's not here right now. This is Pat.
Who is this?
This is Pat Renwick, actually.
Pat Renwick.
I believe Robin is in your chambers.
Other crime-fighting sidekick.
Yes, I'm the mighty Thor.
How's the hair, Thor?
It's good. It's straight from Asgard.
I wonder what would break first, your body or your mind?
Hey, Batman.
My battle with Bane was rather tiring.
Batman.
Young Robert.
Say hello to one of your biggest fans out there.
Hello to my biggest fan out there. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not reading the script.
Yes.
I'm Batman.
There you go.
Hello, Nolan Higgins. I hear you have a soccer game this Saturday, and I hope you do well and vanquish Two-Face for me.
Yes. And tell him to be the ball.
Be the ball, Nolan. The one thing I try to tell the Joker is to be the ball so I can kick him. Because
there
that
it
is.
What
we do is we kick balls.
And just as the phrase we coined here, you know, Mike Iaconelli's got never give up. We have never stop trying.
Iaconelli is not a sponsor of Stray Cats.
That comes out smoother.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Never
Patrick,
stop trying.
Yeah. Patrick,
that's way more of it is.
I'll see you later in the cave in that cat.
Batman, thank
suit.
You so much for
thank
taking
you.
The time to answer the phone on Stray Cats. And Nolan Higgins, you rock it out, man. You are the dude. You are the Big Lebowski. Hey, I want to talk to you guys a little bit about the correlation between the chemistry. We're rolling with the punches. This we got a whole thing here. We got to talk about the correlation of the chemistry between man and woman, and fish, and fishing lure, right?
Where are you going with this, Pat?
Well, Dale, first of all, there's
things you put your mouths on.
Yeah, well, that gets there, but there's first thing is attraction. Okay.
Okay.
Is
that
trivia
that one?
Yes, this is a trivia.
Apparently, this is trivia.
You should be playing sad music, not Jeopardy.
What we're talking about? Well, these are your thoughts.
Yeah, this is thoughts and deep thoughts with Pat Renwick.
I think there's going to be a new segment. What's in Pat's head?
Yes.
Why is there sadness? Is this from a personal root?
No, I don't know what's going on. But here, check this out. Okay, so you have attraction, right? Yeah. First of all, looks. You know, you get a real stunner like DB. You know what I'm saying? Or the dude that everybody says to me, hey, Pat, who's that dude with the awesome beard
on
Stray Cast?
Who's that chick?
That's Ryan Whitacre. That's Ryan Popcorn Whitacre. Okay, so there's
unless
attraction.
Unless Icebox is on.
So, yeah, Icebox, of course.
Icebox has a really
so there's attraction, right? So, you know, the color of your lure, how your lure looks, you know, matching the hatch, the whole deal. That's the appeal to the fish. It's also appeal of the man or the woman, right, in the mating ritual. The
yes.
ritual day
yes.
habitual.
Sure.
See, I'm going like this.
I always thought it was
PG
desperation.
Friendly, you know what I'm saying?
Desperation
and nausea make strange bedfellows, Pat.
I'm keeping it. Yes, that's what they told me.
Somebody just said that chick in the headphones is really hot.
Thanks.
Yeah,
thanks.
Not a problem.
Yeah, yeah, got that going for me. Hey, also, there is what you have as the, you got attraction, right? And then you got, pickup lines, right? So a pickup line is the sound. That's the sound, what you got going, like a spinnerbait or a buzzbait makes a sound.
Or a
crankbait makes a sound. Now, Dale, let's go back before you and Karen, when you were a player back in the 70s with the swishing bell bottoms.
Back to when you were doing turkey calls in bars to pick up chicks.
Yeah, it worked. Now, Dale, I found that the best pickup line is, can I get some fries with that shake booty? Try it, Dale.
Oh, I could never.
Come on.
That.
Can I get some fries with that shake booty?
That's your effervescent.
Can I get some fries with that shake booty?
I can't even try that.
Can I get some fries with that shake booty?
Can I get some fries with that shake booty?
The chicks would be all over them, right? am I serious or what? I'm not. I am definitely not.
I hope not.
The next thing, and probably the most important thing, is pheromones, right? Mm-hmm. Man and women. It's the smell, okay? So if you go in rancid to the club, if you're at the club, shorty, and you're going in there and you're smelling rancid, you're not going to get any.
Need to hear things like that.
Yeah, that's even Sling Blade knows. You're not going to get any. Now, in fishing, pheromones mean a lot, too. Some fishermen catch fish because their smell is appealing to a fish. As stupid as that may sound... It is the truth. As stupid as that may sound, it is the truth, right?
So you honestly think, are you being straight here? You honestly think there are some people, when they pick up a jig and tie it on, they have the thing on their hands that makes them.
They do. They do. Now, for example.
Show's over at 9, Dr. Ruth. Come on.
Hey, come on, Bass Professor. I'm talking about the Bass Professor.
Come on.
You know Doug Henning, the Bass Professor?
He was a magician, Doug Henning?
No, Doug Henning is...
It's an illusion.
He's gone.
Did he play for the Eagles?
He's gone. Doug Henning, the Bass Professor, was a scientist when it came to bass research. The late, great Doug Henning, God rest his soul. He actually would do experiments with the fish and the negative pheromones. He was a runner, and he would run, and he would go jump in his tank full of 10-pound bass. When he would come back stinking from running and jump in the tank, the bass would go the other way. When he didn't stink, the bass would come right to him because of the positive pheromones. The person who had the best pheromones, and I'm making up to this guy for a couple shows ago now, who the bass were always attracted to at that time was who?
Roland Martin.
Was Roland Martin. Thank you very much. It was Roland Martin.
I was going
to
say
Woo. So, Dave, Roland, we're sorry for making fun of your wife and wanting to bang your wife the other day.
Well, that
Oh,
I don't think you have to apologize for that.
Yeah.
That was riveting.
Yeah, so it's there. And Larry, thank you very much.
Oh, anything I could do to help you along.
You've done it.
Could have used the werewolf in that story.
This is Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. Remember, don't put bananas in the boat because of the negative pheromones, as we learned from Chip Ahoy, our buddy.
That's right.
Chip Goy. Yeah. Hey, keep it locked. When we come back, it's Bowman outside. Don't you go anywhere. Mormoniacy is yet to come.
Take your fishing to the next level with StankX Bait Company's soft plastic baits. StankX is a family-owned and operated soft plastic company for Midwest anglers, and their goal is to make baits for anglers that are soft yet durable and continue to help you put more fish in the boat. StankX has a full selection of soft plastics to suit your style of fishing. Every bait is handmade by Travis Crossman, and he makes sure that every bait is flawless. Check out their next-level plastics that are airbrushed to perfection for ultra-realistic paint jobs and fish-catching action. Check out the full line of products at StankXBaitCompany.com. That's Stank, the letter X, BaitCo.com.
Dream. shackled only by freedom. The outdoors is game. Saul said he was restless, but I know the same. He's a viceroy of bourbon. Dale Bowman's his name.
Ooh la la, mon chéri, que le pardon, Dale Bowman, the viceroy of verbiage.
Welcome back, Straight Cast, Outdoor Cartoon Television. You guys didn't know I spoke French, did you? They didn't even know. I hit him with a left hook. I didn't even know what I was speaking right there, but I know that it's time for Bowman Outside on Straight Cast, Outdoor Cartoon Television. DB. What's the fuzz? What's happening?
Well, I'm hoping to see a brown trout video rolling.
Brown trout?
Hey, there we go.
Ooh.
I think that's from Bluegill Bill. Yeah.
Bluegill Bill.
And if it's not, Ralph can call me up.
Is that a tube for a brown trout?
That's
right?
Brown trout rolling in there.
And they're putting in brown trout.
They're putting in brown trout. 30,000.
Uh-oh, he's getting all crazy on us again.
Well, I think this is important stuff.
Well, they're jumping right now.
No, not the brown trout.
He's going hip-hop again.
Yeah, there he goes. Say, can I get some fries with that shake booty?
Can I get some fries with that shake booty?
That's how you do it. Yeah. Now we're talking.
Yeah, Bowman.
Dale Bowman in the house.
You just needed to loosen me up.
I did.
Bowman the Babe Slayer.
Dale Bowman in the house. Yeah.
That was my name. No, but the key thing about... You guys are having too much fun.
That's what this is all about.
The key thing about Browns is I like the idea that they're focusing on them because that they're more of a shoreline fish. They're more of a fish that'll eat what's actually in the lake to be eaten. Namely gobies, yeah. and things like that. Whereas I noticed on Ralph's page when he put the video up, there were still people saying, well, they should be stocking more silverfish. And that just pisses me off because we know that there's a real problem. It does. I'm sorry. We have a real problem with in the lake with food for Chinook and coho, particularly for Chinook.
I had a Chinook hit me up for $5 the other day because he hadn't eaten.
No, they haven't eaten. I'm telling you. Skinny. They look emaciated. You want me to explain
that? That's emaciated.
Emancipated. That's what
Emancipation Proclamation.
So they turned 18?
Yes. The average age of the Vietnam soldier was 19.
That's what I heard.
No, 19.
So these brown trout are not eating like alewives and whatnot as much?
Oh, they'll eat. They will. Yeah, right. They're much more opportunistic, I guess I would say. They're not so focused on alewives such as the Chinook are.
They're a bunch of beeholes.
And I think we're going to be looking at another reduction in Chinook stocking. I think that was pretty much the gist of the last meeting that came out.
Hasn't it pretty much stopped already? I mean,
it's gone way down because they actually started tracking, the feds in the states started tracking how many wild Chinook were actually coming out of the streams, primarily in Michigan, but some in Wisconsin. And it's up to right around 65% or it's wild fish that are coming. We have issues. I mean, the lake, anybody that fishes the lake knows that we have issues and we need to be dealing with them. And just to go back, well, I remember the days when they were dumping all kinds of salmon and we could just go out on the shore and catch them. Well, it's not like that anymore. Things have changed. I mean, for God's sakes, if you walk out in the lake, you can see down on a good day, you can see 20 feet.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
times they are changing.
That 20,
like a fish tank.
Times
yeah.
are changing. Where's Bob Dylan when you need
right.
him?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, the Chinook
was walking on the board when they...
You know, if Bob Dylan was dead, would anyone actually notice?
Oh, he's still
singing?
Alive?
Yes, he is.
Never mind.
Come on. Come on.
And I like him. He's a true viceroy of verbiage.
And it's nice to have a brown trout fishery. That's something to do all winter and spring long.
Yes. And it's here, and you can get them from boat or shore. And both. To me, they're almost as ideal as putting walleye in, but I don't think we're going to see that day. But
we have a show coming up soon exposing the Lake
Michigan
walleye.
Oh, that's right. When are they coming?
It's a secret. I will have it confirmed soon.
You know, stalking brown trout is one of my favorite activities.
Yeah?
Yeah, I do it. You mean usually in the morning?
Just in your spare time, is that it?
Wait, I want to hear this. Exactly what are you doing when you...
Well, I'm sitting down and I'm alone.
Is it after a McDonald's sausage biscuit and coffee? Enough
said. How now, brown trout? Dale, tell us what's going on outside. Come on.
Move on.
Yeah, keep the train shuggling.
Do we got to... Oh, we do have the Lee's tackle photo.
There's Lee.
Hey. Boy, and I think I see Jeff.
Oh, there's John. Yeah, John. And Jeff and Miller. John. And Bobby Berggren.
That guy's on the YouTube.
And that one guy.
Yeah.
That uses a spinning rod.
I'm taking the picture. I use the spinning rod.
I know that.
I told you that.
But I tell you what, that was an interesting time.
That was a good time.
It was.
I mean,
other than a couple of the characters.
Dude, that bait store is awesome.
Oh, yeah,
it is awesome.
Everything there.
Yeah.
There is not a cooler bait store in.
No.
Oh, I thought that was a head shop.
It's a head shop for bass fishermen, is what
it
is. Absolutely.
That's the place to go for all your Japanese domestic
bait. Yeah, serious dudes, man. Serious fishermen. You're going to find those baits. I mean, that was the first time I was in there, honestly, was last Saturday, and I was like, wow. Now this is an establishment.
Don't go into the back
room.
Pat
was just taking stuff off the walls and
John
hiding it
took
in
the
basket.
The back room.
I got a basket right away.
Be careful.
And I shelved stuff before anybody had a chance to get it. And John said, where are you going with that box of stuff? I said, I'm just going to my car. I'll be right back.
John comes up to me because apparently I've gotten a reputation as the guy who fishes for something other than bass.
Yes.
He goes, yes, I have.
Yeah, I know. Creek chubs.
I like creek chubs.
I know you do.
Sometimes I like to see a creek chub.
The story, when I was a kid, we would bring creek chubs home, and the Outdoor Life used to run these photos of trout from the Rocky Mountains.
With Homer Circle?
No.
What?
And Stan Fragerstrom?
Yeah. You're
Uncle Homer, man. Uncle Homer, dude.
Jeff's probably the only other one who understands that.
We're getting nostalgic
today. They would always cut to... the throats on them, and they would have the heads up like this. And so we would cut the throats on our creek chubs and put them on sticks, and we would come walking back the lane to home and make our mom fry them up for us. I mean, they were like that big.
Little chubblers.
Yes. They
little
were little
chub nuggets.
I'm not.
Were they fleshy?
You had little chub nuggets, didn't you?
It was a good time.
Had
it
a
was
chubby.
Cooking food, barbecue.
It was.
Yeah. And he's going to have another one in May.
Were they tumescent?
Oh, it's good.
Mid-May, he's looking to have another open house.
You know what I would love to do? Is do a show from there.
We should. Let's
live
do a remote.
Live remote.
And we could have a band.
Yes.
We would have
You don't like to because he's going to do the work.
We'll
get back to you.
Our producer, Larry.
Show up, Larry.
We'll produce the hell out of
this.
We'd
like to do this.
The box will be about 2 hours long.
You know what I'm trying to get from John is some of those, what are they? Who makes those, Bob?
What?
The evergreen chatterbait. Right. I got my order in. The Brett Height chatterbait.
Clickety clackety.
Oh, jeez. I mean, that Brett Height's, you can't get him here because of the patent. John Moy, please get
he's
us listening. The evergreen
chatterbaits.
He's listening. Please, I beg you. 3/8 green pumpkin.
John Moy. Paging John Moy.
I was smoky actually very excited. So he got excited because he knew I liked to fish for other things than bass. So he was bringing out the secret bag that he had hidden back in the corner that he'd got. And
Gee whiz.
I don't know. Maybe John does do that. I don't know.
That's none of our business.
And it soon won't matter. But he had like little plastic maggots, nuggets.
Ew.
Oh, I mean, it was just tremendous.
Those are delicious.
Yeah. And I can't wait to try them. I'm going to try them with my kids.
I don't like them when they're alive.
I think it's one of those things where I might be able to go like this. Boom, 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 boom. You know.
Hey, Daddy, what you got for us? Plastic maggots, children.
You'll have those in your Christmas stockings and like it, Bowman kids.
Now go play with your bag of tacks and have fun.
I brought them home. My daughter was pulling everything out and looking at it, and she was pretty excited.
Awesome.
She's a pretty good fisher girl. Fisherwoman.
Yes.
How old's a 14-year-old?
Fisherwoman.
14.
Let's call her fisherwoman, you know?
I think fisher girl still.
Fisher team.
I'm still a fisher boy.
It's because of all the...
you are a fisher
boy. It's because of all the chemicals in the milk now that they're fisher women at 14.
Right.
Yeah. Back to the show.
And I'm hanging around the middle school.
Bowman outside.
I'm not sure about that.
With gallons
hey
of milk.
Now. Hey, Mrs. Smith, there's some creepy chick out there in the pickup truck.
It wasn't me.
Hey... A couple things I do want to get in before we get sidetracked.
Yes, let's not
get
sidetracked.
The It's not sidetrack. It's
what can I get some fries with that shake booty?
Oh, you want me to do that?
I
again,
just
don't.
Do
a turkey call.
You want some fries with that shake booty?
That's awesome. That is awesome right
now. I do
right.
want to do the turkey call again.
Okay.
And
that's later.
Which, no, that's right now, actually.
Oh, okay.
Can I do that?
Cock-a-doodle-do.
He's oh, trying no, to pick no, up nope. chicks here on the air.
Yeah.
I
that's our Dale.
There it is.
Turkey season in Illinois has actually been off to a pretty good start, surprisingly, considering how much the wind has been blowing, how cold it's been, how much it's been snowing and raining. But I find
miserable.
It interesting. It has been miserable, but apparently the turkeys gobble, are still gobble, doing gobble. What comes naturally, like most of us.
Eating?
Yeah. Having relations?
Having
eating and strutting?
Yes. The mating
the
ritual.
The physical act of love coitus, Dale?
The, yes.
What were we talking
about? Oh, you're talking about coitus.
Turkey love.
Coitus.
Turkey love.
You turkey pheromones.
They're gobbling it up, so to speak.
Yeah.
Gobbling what? It up, so to speak. Thank you, Bobby.
So thanks. What you're I saying is...
Back to the chubbies.
Yes. Chicago Maritime Festival is Saturday.
Hello,
at Old Town School of Music. I have yet to go to it, and I keep meaning to, but the problem is they always have it like in April when there are other things I want to do, like go fishing. So.
Or having relations.
With
or
turkeys.
Relations. With turkeys.
Coitus.
Wait, what?
Because it's turkey hunting season.
Riverside Fishing Club is having a fishing tackle swap meet. That's a pretty big-time club, so you might... If you're into swap
what is
meet,
it, Dale?
It's a fishing tackle swap meet, Riverside Fishing Club,
dirty.
Out at LaGrange American Legion, Saturday.
Oh, even the veterans are getting in on the scene now, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, you're never mind.
No, that's where they generally
never
meet, because it's okay. Big enough
swap
space.
Meets, yeah.
And Lake Michigan kayak fishing class is up at Lake Michigan Angler in Winthrop Harbor. And
really?
To me, I think that...
That's
one of
thing?
The coolest things I've ever done in my life is kayak on Lake Michigan.
Really?
And
that's not the coolest thing you've ever done. The coolest thing you've ever done is picked up a chick in a bar using
oh,
a turkey.
Turkey
yeah,
call.
You can't
okay,
top
that.
That
was pretty cool.
How can you
okay.
top?
Oh, come on,
does
Dick.
Karen
you're
know about that?
I'm never letting that go. That's,
I don't
that's
think
legendary.
She listens, so I don't think
oh,
she'll
okay.
find out unless you say something.
Where do you
no,
go on Wednesday
I'll text
dear.
Her. You would I'll text her and let her know.
Every year the kayak... fishing on Lake Michigan is evolving. I see
yes.
more and more out there.
And, yeah. and they're really good at catching them, too. Part of it is you're able to get in and out. It's kind of like operating a bass boat instead of a more traditional trolling boat. You can go to where you need to go, and they know how to troll. So let's say that you're going around. Let's say that this is a dock.
My phone is a dock.
That phone
if,
is a dock.
If you're
that
with
phone.
A kayak, you can... You control right by
standards and
the
practices,
dock.
Right?
So, and I mean that's one of there are some serious advantages to doing.
Never mind, you just
that
said dock.
Advantages, and they lost a guy last year. Is that there is some danger involved?
Oh. Yeah, definitely. And, yeah,
I mean,
be careful out
yeah,
there.
Yeah, it does get dangerous
doing.
Quick.
I
but it's
was
a lot
of
guys
sturgeon.
When they're going for the coho, you know, they got the two rod holders in the yep. back, and they're just drifting
just
around, dragging skein behind it yep. on the bottom rig.
Yeah,
they're catching the heck out of them.
Oh, that's a very effective method. I
it's,
mean,
free.
And
it's free.
It's free. And
no gas.
The problem is there's still some issues in where you can dump in and can't dump in Chicago. God
once you're
bless.
In, you're in.
Yeah.
Where can
once
you
you're
dump
in, you're in. That's the problem then is
and
getting
once
out.
You're
stop
in, you're in.
Where can
yeah.
you dump
and
in
you're
Chicago?
Out, you're out.
Legally or?
Legally.
Legally.
Legally, I'm not sure which spots you can legally dump in.
I'm assuming you can use boat ramps, right?
Yeah.
You
can't
mean,
put on the beaches or anything? They don't let
no,
that?
No, you can't put
or you
it
can't bring the kayak on the beach.
No.
You can do it over in Whiting.
You can
Whiting,
do whatever
you
want in Indiana.
Yeah,
Indiana.
Indiana.
It's the wild, wild west over here.
We don't make no laws, man. That's
thank
like
God
Homer,
for the
Homer
GOP.
Glenn.
There's
you got to dance with who brung
no
you.
Laws apply. So, shout out to Jeff Miller on the Homer Glenn reference.
There it is.
Nice.
Boom.
Homer Glenn.
You got anything else, Dale?
No, we're done.
Bowman outside is a wrap. Good job, Dale.
Thank you.
Hey.
That was great, Dale.
Why, Dale? I'm your biggest fan.
Coitus?
Hey, Bowman outside. Make sure you check out Dale Bowman's column in the Chicago Sun-Times every Wednesday and
Sunday.
Wednesday and Sunday, Dale Bowman, Chicago Sun-Times. He is the Viceroy of Verbiage. I am Pat Renwick. This is Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television, and we're going to need you to keep it locked because when we get back, it is the legendary Kevin Short, K-Pink. Don't you go nowhere.
Okay, I suppose you're wondering why Larry popped up the photo of Chef Todd with the critter. The critter, I think, is a groundhog, if I remember right. Well, part of it is I just want to butter up Chef Todd so we can get him in the stalwart section. But the other part is that Todd is one of the most innovative writers, and I use that term loosely, at Heartland Outdoors in their magazine section. He can talk about anything from fishing to food. He's a specialist in both. I also happen to write for Heartland Outdoors magazine. If you're a deer hunter, you already know heartlandoutdoors.com because it's the place to go if you're an Illinois deer hunter or anybody who hunts the Midwest. Heartlandoutdoors.com and magazine.
All right!
I mean, woo!
Woo!
Woo! Berkeley, woo! The official equipment provider of Woo.
PH Custom Lures by Phil Hunter quickly becoming the most sought-after custom balsa baits in the industry. From the Little Hunter to the Squeaky Pea, these baits are pure quality, handcrafted, hand-carved, and hand-painted. But most importantly, they flat-out catch fish. PH Custom Lures has a bait for any situation in a magnitude of colors. Check out the Old School, Straighter, and PH Custom series at phcustomlures.com. That's PH Custom.
Welcome back, Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I am Pat Renwick. It is time for the Bass Buzz segment of the show, where every week we bring you the nation's top bass fishing professionals. And right now, we are dialing up the one and only, the legendary KPink, Kevin Short. Let's see what Kev's doing.
Where's
Kevin at? There's KPink. Kevin Short, welcome to the big show, dude.
Going on.
Oh, heck yeah, man. KPink, welcome to Hammond, Indiana and the Straight Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television Studios.
Well, welcome to Mountain Home, Arkansas, and the friend and the home of my friends Brenda and Kenny Gibson.
Nice, nice. What, you just chilling with some pals tonight?
We're having some little lasagna and I don't know what I'm drinking here, but it's really good.
Is that a crankbait on that cup?
What is that on that cup? Is that a
It's a razorback.
It's a razorback. What else? Of course it is.
It's a razorback crankbait.
Come on. What do you expect?
You know, I love this, man. I mean, it's the life of a bass fishing professional behind the scenes. KPink sitting back eating some Italian food and sipping out of a razorback cup. It don't get no better than that.
It doesn't get any better than that. So how are you guys?
We're doing good, man. It's great to have you on the show. It's great to talk to you again. It's been a while since the old Bass Buzz radio show, but now we're big TV stars, Kevin.
I know, it's great.
Yeah, I mean,
I love the show, by the way.
Well, thank you very much. We're just here having a good time. We don't know what we're doing, but it works somehow or another. I don't know.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Hey, Kevin, how's fishing, dude?
It's good. I mean, not that I've been doing as much as I used to since kind of changed professions there a little bit, but it's been good. I mean, I've really enjoyed kind of moving into a different role here as doing international sales for bass cat and yardcraft boats. And I like what I'm doing. It's fun.
Yeah. I mean, how cool is that? You are the international salesman for Bass Cat, man. I mean, talk about a sales call. We were talking the other day. Your nearest client's 18 hours away by plane.
Well, by driving, it's 18 hours 18. From my house. Yeah,
okay,
yeah,
gotcha.
Yeah. My closest dealer is in Nestor Falls, Ontario. So
wow.
Yeah, it's like 18 hours from the house. So I spend a lot of time on the on an airplane going different places. And it's, internet, Bass Cat has always sold boats. You know, we've always sold boats to Canada. We've always sold boats to Japan. We've got, a new dealer and a new distributor down in Australia that, we got Carl Jacobson now the Aussie phenom when a bass cat, and he's working with us down there in Australia, and that's a man. Those guys, let me tell you what, those guys in Australia are it's a small group of anglers down there, but they are absolutely eaten alive with bass fishing. And you know what the strange thing is? Let me tell you what the strange thing is. They don't even have bass in Australia.
What?
And they're crazy about it. No, they do not. They fish for barramunda, and they fish for
crocodiles.
They've got some kind of perch down there that they fish for. They don't have bass like we have bass.
Okay.
They don't have smallmouth. They don't have largemouth. Any of that. So it's totally different species that they fish for. They use bass boats, and they use a lot of the same tackle and stuff that we do. Okay. But the species are totally different. So, and that's what kind of, I mean, Carl's story is pretty interesting because this is a guy that grew up fishing for, it's almost like a cat fisherman coming to the bass fishing world, and suddenly he's an Elite Series angler.
And he's wrecking them. He's absolutely wrecking them.
Yeah. Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's a great story. But, you know, we've got pockets like that of really, really cool anglers around the globe, you know, and it's been really cool to go and meet some of those people and work with them, you know, open up new dealers in different countries and stuff and sell boats, man. It's been great.
That's a cool deal. And how's Japan, man? I mean, how is it going over to Japan? I know bass fishing is just off the hook there, so proverbially. Yes.
There's a, we've got Kota Kiriyama that's been in the bass cat for a long time. He is kind of our Japanese representative and does, you know, he does a really good job over there. And those people are as, you know, rabid about it as the people in Australia are. There's just a lot more of them, obviously. And they're all packed into a really small island. Yeah, you know, it's pretty interesting because I think Australia has like almost just a little bit less than the same land mass that the United States has, but they have a tenth of the population. Okay,
it's crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy. Japan has like a tenth of the land mass, and they have more people than we do. So it's like two totally different kind of realms there, you know. But yeah, the Japanese are absolutely. It's interesting. The Japanese, most of them, unlike us, you know, those of us, you know, obviously that have boats. Well, we all keep our. I mean, where do you keep your boat at? You keep it in the garage at your house, right?
Yes.
Okay. You or if you don't have a garage,
are outside in a cover.
Exactly, outside under the cover.
Yeah.
Well, in Japan, you know, most of the housing over there is so small, there's very few people that can actually keep a boat at their house. They have to keep it at the marina at the lake. So the marinas there have these huge parking lots where all the boats are stored. So when you go fishing, you go to the marina, they hook your boat up, put your boat in the water for you. It's a totally different, you know, it's a totally different kind of thing, man. And it's interesting to learn all these things.
It's like boat caddies they got going over there.
It's like boat caddies.
It's like boat caddies. Hey, can you see us, Kevin?
Yeah.
Okay. I want to introduce you to the crew here. Okay. All right. Because I don't think you know this guy. He's the outdoor columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times. This is Dale Bowman, who's sitting to my right here.
Bowman.
That's old Dale Bowman. This is the Southside Smallmouth Samurai to my left.
Nice.
This is Bobby Berggren. And over there in the Cubs hat, I don't know if you can see Ryan over there. He's Ryan Popcorn Whitacre. That's the dude over there.
Popcorn, I like
that's
that.
Old Popcorn Whitacre because he makes these little finesse jigs that look like popcorn and they catch the heck out of the smallmouth around here.
Really?
It's amazing. I'm going to have him send you some, Kev.
Okay, I'd like to see some of those.
And you try them out. Hey, Kevin. Major league fishing, dude. Major league fishing. One of the cool, and we talk about this with a lot of the guys that come on the show, but I can't tell you how ecstatic I am about the whole format and the whole concept of major league fishing. What are your feelings on it?
And let me tell you what, I think major league fishing is the future of tournament fishing. Okay, I really do. I think that some, and I don't know, You know, I'm not going to say that the format that we have right now with Major League Fishing is the ultimate format, but it's pretty darn close. I think it's the basis for what tournament fishing will be in the future. Okay. I think that is totally the direction. And, you know, the biggest thing, obviously, for me is the conservation side of it, because in Major League Fishing, we don't even need live wells in the boat, man.
Right.
Because we catch fish, the boat official weighs it, we verify the weight, we put the fish back in the water. You know, in less than 20 seconds, we're good to go on catching another. You know, we're not putting the fish in the live well, we're not beating them up on 2-hour boat rides, we're not, you know, dragging them through weigh-in lines, none of that. Just simply from a conservation side of it, man, that is a great way to do tournaments at that level. Now, I'm not going to say it's the best for every, you know, like for clubs, for everybody, but to, you know, for that level, man, it is fantastic. And from a competitor side of it, it's great because all I have to worry about is catching fish.
Right.
You know, I don't have to worry about, well, okay, are the live wells working right? Is there enough water in there? You know, did I hook that one real deep? Is he going to make it? You know, am I going to get a penalty? Because none of that. I mean, it is fantastic. From a competitive side, it is so much. You got to look at those totally different than you do in an elite series event. An elite series event is all about catching the 5 biggest fish every single day. Okay. An MLF event, whether it is a cup event or a select event, that's all about catching the most fish you can catch every single day. They don't have to be the biggest ones. You don't have to catch 3, 4, 5 pounders. If you catch 12 inches, you know, if you catch 112 inches,
you're in. That's a deal.
As opposed to if you catch 5, 4 pounders, you know,
exactly.
It's great.
Hey, Kevin, let me ask you this. Speaking of being in, how does one get in to Major League Fishing? Do you have to be invited? Do you have to pay an entry fee? People ask me that, and I'm like, you know what? I don't know. Okay.
There's two different groups. You know, in MLF, you see two different shows, basically. You see the cup shows, which are like the cup events are the original 24 guys that were based. I mean, they basically got together and formed Major League Fishing. Okay. And it was, you know, it started out as a real small group, and they kind of invited guys that they knew, you know, but, and I don't know what the criteria was, but just kind of from my side looking at it, was mostly guys that they knew would be good on television. You know, they had good personalities. They could obviously catch fish. Okay. And they felt like those original 24 guys could make a good TV show.
Gotcha.
Okay? And that's what it's all about. That's what MLF is all about, is making an entertaining television show. It's not about having a tournament. It's really not about who catches the most fish. I mean, yeah, that's the game, but it's about making some entertaining television.
Viewer friendly.
Viewer friendly. Yep. Thank you. Very good. Very good.
Well, thank you.
So you got those original 24. And there was, you know, there was over the course of the first 4 or 5 years, there was some of the guys that kind of maybe wanted to move on and do something different. Okay. Well, there was another group of 24 that, I mean, basically that group was invited. Okay.
Okay. Gotcha.
And that's the selects. Okay. That's what I mean. And what the selects fish for is to advance to the cup events. Okay, so basically we got two different levels there. We got the cup, which is where you want to be, and the selects is kind of like the feeder circuit for the selects. Okay, and we get feeder cup for the cup. We get points, every one of the selects. I mean, we get points, you know, for how we finish, whether we win or even finish second, third, fourth. We get points and accumulate those points and build up. And like this past year, Andy Montgomery and Brent Chapman did well enough in the selects that now, next year, they actually moved up into the cup events.
Okay.
It opened up 2 more spots in the selects. So,
but I still don't understand. How do you get into the selects?
Oh, you got to be invited.
You got to be invited. Okay, okay.
Yes,
okay.
It is strict. At this point, it is a strictly invitation only. And it is, and there again, I'm not privy to this, you know, the selection process, anything like that. But from what I see, looking at the other guys that are in selects, for the most part, it's guys that have personality.
Gotcha. So, hey, are you saying that if I take Gary Klein and Boyd Duckett on an Amazon fishing trip, that I might have a chance?
Maybe. Definite maybe.
Definite maybe.
Definite maybe.
Hey, Kevin, you want to stick around for another segment, man?
Sure, let's do it.
All right, we're going to pull up the trolling motor. We're going to put the power poles down, and we're going to stay right here. We'll be right back. More Bass Buzz segment on Straightcast Outdoor Cartoon Television with Kevin Short when we return. Don't you go anywhere.
Edwin Evers here, 2016 Bassmaster Classic Champion. In celebration of Lowrance winning the last five Bassmaster Classics, we're going to extend the Ultimate Upgrade promo. If you buy an HDS Gen 3 with Structure Scan 3D, we're going to mail you a $300 rebate. Five Bassmaster Classic Champions in a row. That doesn't happen by chance. That happens because these units are the best.
29 pounds, 3 ounces!
Edwin Evers here, 2016 Bassmaster Classic Champion. In celebration of Lowrance winning the last five Bassmaster Classics, we're going to extend the Ultimate Upgrade promo. If you buy an HDS Gen 3 with Structure Scan 3D, we're going to mail you a $300 rebate. Five Bassmaster Classic Champions in a row. That doesn't happen by chance. That happens because these units are the best. 29!
Oh yes, ooh la la, a little Van Halen, DOA. Bass Buzz segment, Straightcast Outdoor Cartoon Television. We're back with Kevin Short. Kevin, welcome back, bud.
Thank you, Pat. Appreciate that.
Hey, you got any? Yeah, well, dude, it's our pleasure. Come on, man. You're one of our faves, dude. I mean, anybody that likes to fish shallow and wind a square bill all day, that's my dude.
All day long.
That's my dude, man. Hey, speaking of that, hey, you want to bring some guests out real quick? You want your friends to say hi?
They've already declined. No.
Are you serious?
Yeah,
they're offending Ryan Popcorn Whitacre right now.
I'm sorry, Ryan. I apologize for my friends. Have a good time in there without.
Dale Bowman was going to write an article in the Chicago Sun-Times about them, and now they're not going to come out and say hi.
Hey, Kevin, I've got one more question about MLF. How long is each period? They never tell us on the show how long period is.
Each in the selects, each one is 2.5 hours.
2.5.
Okay. So you got 3 2.5 hour periods, and then there's like a 30-minute break in between, you know, the first and second period.
Okay, and you guys have to go to a check-in point?
Yeah. I mean, we, you know, basically, you know, we pull up to the ramp. They give us about 30 minutes to get everything ready and hand us this little, usually it's a little Mickey Mouse paper map that basically has an outline of the body of water.
Yeah,
that's all that's on it. Yeah. And it'll have, you know, like a little X mark where we're supposed to come back to and put the boats in the water. And they've got a set time that we start, and from then we've got 15 minutes that we can drive around anywhere in the lake and just look. We can't make a cast, can't stand up, you know, out of the driver's seat. We can't do anything but look for 15 minutes. At the end of that 15 minutes, that first 2.5 hour period starts. Okay. And the boat official, you know, he's sitting right there and he said, you know, we're going to start in 1 minute.
Lines in.
Lines in. Counts it down, you know, 10, 9, 3, you know, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, lines in, and you can start fishing. 2.5 hours. At the end of that 2.5 hours, we've got 30 minutes that before the next period starts, and we have to go back to a preset rendezvous point. Now, if it takes us 15 minutes to get back there, then that, I mean, we'll only have 15 minutes before we have to leave again. Okay. And there's been, I think the show that they just filmed or that you guys just saw this past week up in Ohio. There were some guys fishing. I think Ott and somebody else was fishing way up this creek.
Yeah, like 30 minutes or miles.
It actually took them longer than 30 minutes to get back because it was an idle zone.
Okay? Oh, geez.
So, I mean, that kind of comes into play. But yeah, okay, so we got 30 minutes. We can retie, you know, drink, eat, whatever.
Drink your squincher.
So you can
your
fish.
Your squinchers.
You can fish squinchers. All the way up until the end of that 2.5 hour period. Then you can fish all the way, and then you have your half hour to get back there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, at the end of that 2.5 hour period, I mean, it's like lines out, and I mean, you're done. You know, you can't fish anymore, and you got to go back to the rendezvous point until the next period starts. And then you got another 2.5 hour period and you do it all over. And the thing, you know, it's kind of interesting because there's been a couple of them where, you know, at the end of one of those periods, you kind of get on a little something and figure a little something out. Okay. And then you got to stop. And by the time that you get back to that same exact spot where you were catching them, it's like, dead.
They throw a monkey wrench in your momentum is what's going on. That's what they're doing.
But that's part of the game. You know?
That's what gets you going. Hey man, you love fishing shallow water, Kevin.
Oh yeah.
I mean, you're Arkansas boy. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that you were born and bred with. And you love winding that square bill crankbait.
Yes, sir.
I mean, what's the infatuation with the square bill crankbait and where did that start for you?
You know, I had a team partner years ago that he actually fished a draw tournament, you know, kind of a pro-am tournament with this guy from South Arkansas that was one of those old school Bagley masters.
Oh, yeah.
Had thousands and thousands of Bagleys. And it was a hot summer. It was like a, you know, 1st of July event, you know, smells like somebody's ironing clothes at 9 o'clock in the morning. You're so hot, you know, your tennis shoes, you know, melt to the asphalt kind of thing. And this guy absolutely blew. I mean, he won the tournament by like 10 pounds. I mean, he just crushed them. And it hooked my buddy Dennis on throwing. Cause this, I mean, this guy, George Bowman, as a matter of fact, George Bowman from Dumas, Arkansas, he might be related to your Mr. Bowman there.
It is. He caught those bass in the corner up there.
I was just admiring that.
That's a bunch of 6-pounders, dude.
Yeah. George.
That's from Arkansas. They're from Arkansas.
Really?
What's the lake? Well, the Gray.
There you go.
Yeah.
George actually gave my buddy Dennis, you know, a couple of Bagleys. So he started throwing them. And, you know, we were fishing team events together. And he got me to throwing them. And, you know, we didn't know what we were doing, but we knew enough that we knew where to throw it and when to throw it. And, I mean, we started winning some money on it, you know? So it was like, oh, my God, we got to have more of these. So we ordered, like, this was when Bagley was going really strong. We ordered, like, a gross Balsa B2s in 09.
You know, the old chartreuse in black.
Chartreuse black. Yeah. We ordered 144 of the things and split them.
The old 09s. I love it.
Oh, yeah. He got 72 of them. I got 72 of them. And I still have quite a few of them.
You want to get rid of some of those, Kev?
Nope. Thank you. but, you know, that kind of got us started. And we, you know, we threw it more and more and learned, you know, a lot about it. And when I, you know, when I started fishing like the invitationals and stuff way back in the 90s, I actually, got to be, pretty good friends with, Klun, And I learned, you know, a lot of what I learned from, you know, fishing a couple of days with Clun and kind of over the years, you know, we had mutual friends and, you know, it just kind of worked out real well. And he's, you know, he's one of those guys that was throwing it way before we were.
Absolutely. So, he was. Yeah, yes.
I mean, we were throwing it way back in the 80s when they first came out. And he, you know, he's taught me a lot about it, both, you know, with times that I've been in the boat with him and just talking to him.
Well, Kevin, share us some of this knowledge that you have acquired and that maybe Clun has taught you. Share some with us and the viewers about, well, give us a little tip, man. Give us a tip we might not know.
There's two things that I think a lot of people, there's two little kind of nuances that I think a lot of people kind of overlook or they miss when you're throwing square bills, particularly when you're talking about throwing them around targets,
okay?
Whether it's docks, stumps, trees, laydowns, whatever. The first of them is persistence, okay? I mean, I can't tell you how many times that I've caught really big fish by making multiple casts to one stump, one lay down, one log, whatever. And I'm talking about 6, 8, 10 casts to the same target to get that one fish to bite. Okay? I mean, you have to be persistent. You can't make just one cast on this side, one cast on that side, and go to the next one. Sometimes you can, okay? If the fish are really aggressive, sometimes you can do that. But a lot of times, I mean, you have to make multiple casts to one of those targets. The second thing is when you're making those casts, you don't want to, and not necessarily want to make them from the same angle. You know, a lot of times what I'll do is I'll be moving the boat, you know, I'll be moving the bass cat past the stump, past the lay down, and I'll actually go around it, okay? And I'll actually go all the way around the stump, if I can, making casts all the way around it from different angles just to catch that one fish. And what a lot of times when a square bill works, particularly when you're fishing targets like that, is when the fishing is tough, it's hard to get a bite. So when you get a bite, it's usually one that you want to catch, and it's a good one, okay?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's typically not one of those things where you're going to catch 40 or 50 fish a day, okay? And nobody else in the field is either. It's one, you know, it really shines when you're only going to get 6 or 7 bites a day, regardless of what you're doing. It doesn't matter if you're flipping, throwing a spinnerbait, a frog, whatever. You're only going to get 5 or 6 bites. A lot of times when it's tough like that, and you're fishing targets, particularly wood targets, that's when the square bill is the best tool that you can use. Because you can, you know, you can work it around those targets and get those bites. And a lot of times, like I say, it's the bite you want to get. It's the bite you want to have in the box.
Yeah, absolutely. That's going on the port side. That's the good one. That's the good. And multiple casts. How about speed? I know Clun, man, he winds the hell out of those things.
I'm the same way. I'm chunking it out there. I'm bringing it home. This ain't no David Fritz sit down on the front with the 5-to-1 gear ratio lose. No, sir. I'm throwing it out there. I'm bringing it home. All right. I mean, I'm making a lot of casts. And most of the time when you're doing that, you're making real short casts. You know, you're making 20, 25 foot, maybe 30 foot casts at the longest. So, I mean, it's a repetition thing. You know, the more cast you can make, the more water you can cover, the more times you can put the bait in front of the fish, the better your odds are on catching it.
And, dude, I have seen you wreck them on that square bill, man.
Hey, it's one of those things that when it works, nothing else will, and you will absolutely crush them.
You've made some fish story right there. Hey, how important to you are electronics in shallow water angling?
They're really not, Pat.
Okay. I want to hear it.
They are in some respects, okay? Because a lot of times when you're fishing shallow water, and I'm going to say, you know, less than 5 foot.
Gotcha.
A lot of times a 6-inch to 1 foot difference can make a huge difference. you know, if you find a series of stumps that are a foot deeper than all the other stumps, that can be huge. So, yes, I mean, yes and no. Electronics, just for the pure, you know, the sheer depth reading, water temperature. I tell you what, GPS in those situations is more important to me a lot of times than depth, because what you'll find when, you know, when you're fishing targets, particularly when you're fishing laydowns, maybe that, I mean, some of the best, I mean, I remember some of the best laydowns that I ever found were those that were totally submerged and you couldn't see them till you got right up on top of them. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thanks to GPS, I can mark those on my, you know, on the HDS9 that I've got on the front. I mean, I can, I mean, this is KPink's handy little tip for the day.
Okay, get it.
When you find one of those stumps or a big lay down, a log, whatever, that's underwater that you know is going to be holding fish, I will mark both ends of that lay down with a waypoint so that I know how to get lined up on it when I come back to it.
You're double marking on the low rants.
I will mark it on the low end on both. I mean, I'll get right up on top of it and mark one end of it and then troll up there to where the other end's at and mark that. So I know that I need to throw my bait at this angle to come across that sucker just right to get that fish to bite. And
dude,
that is a big advantage right there.
That's a tip. That is a tip right there.
That's a tip. You got it.
Hey, if throwing a square bill crankbait involved a 1-2 punch, what's the second punch? What's number two?
I'm going to flip either a jig or, a beaver-style bait, like a Zoom Z-Hog. That's going to be my backup. All right? I'm going to throw my crankbait, go all the way around the log. If I don't get him to bite, I'm going to come back, and I'm going to flip all the way around it.
And just work the heck out of it. But you're spending lots of time in one area.
Yeah, well, and I tell you, a lot of times what you'll find is there'll be particular, you know, if you spend enough time doing this, you'll find particular targets, whether it's, you know, some days, some lakes, whatever, they might be on laydowns, not on stumps. Other days, they're on stumps, not on laydowns, okay? And those are little things that you kind of, you know, you kind of pick up on those things as the day goes on, all right? And, yeah, you're going to spend a lot of time on one stump, one lay down. But if you've got 20 or 30 of them to fish and you catch one fish off of every five, you caught six fish. It's a law of averages thing, man.
Persistence.
Persistence. Got it. You got to be persistent. When you know, in those situations, tough fishing, you know, you're only going to get six or seven bites, you know, if that during the day, you have to be persistent.
Hey, Kevin, share with your fans something that they don't know about you. A little known Kevin Short fact.
Wow. Little known Kevin Short fact. Here is a little known Kevin Short fact.
Nice. Deep thoughts.
I graduated from high school a year early.
Wow.
Not that I was smarter than anybody else. I thought I was smarter than everybody else, but I actually went to summer school in my sophomore year. And got enough extra credits where I actually graduated from high school in my junior year. So there you go.
More time to fish.
More time to fish.
More time to fish. Hey, Kevin, man. Yeah, okay. If everybody wants to find out about you, of course they could see you on Major League Fishing. Yes. There's the KPink Facebook page.
That's the best place right there.
Yeah, just check you out on KPink, Kevin Short, professional angler, on the book face. Yeah.
Yes, on the book face, send me a message. I will send you a reply back. It may take me a couple of days, but I will get back to you, I promise.
He's going to send you an autographed old Bagley 09 crankbait.
No, Pat, I'm not going
to
do that.
Okay, I had to try. I had to try. Kevin.
You won. But I don't know that I said everybody won. No, I probably won't do that.
Kevin, thank you so much for coming on the Bass Buzz segment of Stray Cast Outdoor Television. It's always a pleasure, man, to speak with you, dude.
Always great to be here. Thank you guys very much. Appreciate it.
Enjoy the rest of your lasagna and your Razorback drink.
See you guys. Be good.
Take care, Kevin. Best of luck to you. Hey, Kevin Short, KPink, professional bass fisherman. That dude is a champ.
Outrageous Outdoors is quickly becoming the industry leader in tournament fishing apparel. There's no better way to represent your sponsors than with a Outrageous jersey. At Outrageous, you can get a short sleeve, long sleeve, sweatpants, the best prices in the industry. Outrageous also offers club and team discounts, special high school and college prices. Our website is easy to navigate, and Outrageous' staff will make the process quick and easy for you. Outrageous Outdoors, offering high-quality tournament apparel for the weekend angler. Outfit yourself from head to toe. Check out Outrageous online at www.outrageous.com. Outrageous Outdoors.
I wish there was a jig that I could flip, swim, and drag with.
You need them jigs.
Yeah, I do need them jigs.
Not them jigs, them jigs.
Oh!
Custom hooks, hand-tied living rubber skirts, and an indestructible chip-proof head. Available in both football and the flip-swim style. Jigs built out of a necessity for the serious fisherman. Like them jigs on Facebook or order online at themjigs.com. That's D-E-M-Jigs.com.
Where do you go for all the hard-to-find Japanese domestic tackle? Lee's Global Tackle, the connection for all the hottest baits and lures straight from Japan. Lee's Global Tackle has two locations, the main store in Elk Grove Village, Illinois, and our other store in Carroll Stream, Illinois. Stop in at Lee's Global Tackle and meet John Moy. He'll show you some of the coolest baits not available anywhere else. Catering secret tournament-winning baits to the fishing community.
Yowza, yowza, yowza. Welcome back, Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. We're swimming at you live, like smallmouth. We're swimming at you live. You know why? Because this is Outdoor Cartoon Television. That's Dale Bowman. I'm Pat Renwick. That's the popcorn over there, Ryan Whitaker. And this is the boy wonder, the Southside Smallmouth Samurai, Bobby Bergeron, who you just heard the song about. And Bobby, who is this dude over here to your left?
That is Jeff Miller, a seasoned veteran on Lake Michigan.
Seasoned veteran.
Top competitor.
Is that like onion and garlic powder? Or
seasoned.
Yes, well seasoned. Welcome, Jeff Miller.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jeff. We love Jeff Miller.
Audience. Yeah.
Jeff
Miller in studio.
Awesome.
Now, I came home today, and my mom's like, "You got a box in the mail." I'm like, "All right, what's wrong with it?" It's like, "It stinks."
Oh, yeah.
And I just got a whole bunch of these new darters from Stank X Bait Co. The doppelgangers, actually.
The doppels.
And they're loaded with scent. We got a few new ones to show off today. We got the Esquacho with the Esquacho tightrope jig. Now, check that one out, Jeff. What do you think about that on Lake Michigan?
Absolutely sweet. Sweet.
Now, notoriously, this is a good spring color, but it works all the time. And fall.
And fall, yeah.
But one that works all the, I'd say about 70% of the time, it works every time. And that's watermelon gold. And this is the new color he just made. That's camo right there. And I see popcorn. I actually want to call this one RW Gold because he told Crossman to make it.
Sure. Yeah.
I think your mic's off, Ryan. Is it off? Uh-oh. He might not be on. But
where'd
yes,
Ryan
this
go?
Is the, Ryan's a ghost right now.
I'm a ghost.
And this is an absolute killer. You know, Jeff, what color darters do you like throwing on the lake?
You know, you just brought up watermelon gold. Anytime that water is gin clear out there, which is a lot, especially out through the summer, I do rely on some type of watermelon, whether it be watermelon purple, watermelon gold, watermelon just black flake. Anytime it gets a little bit darker or a little bit dingier, I just try to darken up the color a little bit, maybe a darker green pumpkin or Ryan makes a brown that I throw quite often, too.
Oh, cool. So you throw the tight ropes as well.
Yes, I do. Absolutely.
I thought that was our little secret, Ryan. Now you're giving them
it
to Jeff.
It's out of the bag.
He bought a whole sack of them last year. So.
The popcorn jig's out of the bag. It's the original Midwest Great Lakes smallmouth finesse jig, right? Don't forget it. Don't be fooled by the imitation.
That's
back
right.
to you, Bob.
Now, check out some of these on StankXBaitCo.com. This segment has been brought to you by Lee's Global Tackle.
Yeah.
Who else? JDM Tackle Members Only.
Yeah. .com.
Shimano.
Shimano.
And Jackal. Boom.
Jackal.
Now, Jeff Miller, I have a little lunchbox here. Uh-oh. You packed it up for me today.
Yes.
I need you to dig in here and out one of
dig
your
Dig in Bobby's
baits.
Box.
Yes.
Okay.
Get in there nice and deeply like Jeff.
All right.
Now, what are you going to pull out first? What are you thinking about?
I don't know what I'm going to pull out first.
Can you have Bozo Circus music or no?
So, he's pulling out.
Is that an oatmeal cream pie?
Oh.
What?
Now, this is a Duo Realis spin bait.
Huh?
Now, this is something I'm not too fortified in. I don't know this technique as well as you do.
Okay.
And you brought it in here for a reason, because you want to talk about it. Now, how does this work for you? What's the deal behind the spin bait?
Number one, it came from Japan. They've been doing it for years. It's a sinking bait that you want to throw on light line. 6 pound test is that where you know where you want to be at. 8 pound you can go, but anywhere around 10 pound, it's gonna not make the bait work properly. I throw it on braid, 10 pound braid with 6 pound leader. I throw it on a spinning rod.
What kind of spinning rod are you throwing?
I throw a Loomis rod, NRX rod with it. You got to have a soft tip rod.
Okay.
Okay. I throw on a sustain reel, Shimano sustain reel, and like I said, 6 pound leader. The key thing is you're counting it down. If you're fishing a 12 foot depth, you know, you want to get it down about 10 foot and a slow, very slow retrieve. It's a little secret on St. Clair the last couple years that's been winning tournament after tournament
Absolutely.
After tournament on St. Clair.
Oh, yeah.
It is working up in Sturgeon Bay. I know a lot of guys are throwing on Geneva, where Ryan fishes quite often, and I'm playing with it on the lake quite a bit here at home. I'm tweaking it. That's what I'm doing.
Tweaking.
Hey, Jeff, why is that line size so important, though? That's what I don't get.
Okay, the line size, the 6 pound test line size is sort of bait shimmies, and that's what it does.
Okay, so on the fall, it's going to bevel
yes,
down.
As you're reeling in very slow, and as you stop, it just shimmies, and it's a very, very tight shimmy. It's hard to see with the eye unless you have it in a tank where you can see very clear. It's a clear water bait. It's not meant for dirty water by any means. But the shimmy is the whole deal. And as you're reeling it in, there's two props on each end, almost like an old devil's horse back in the day.
Yeah.
That's a top water bait. And what do they call spy baiting? Because it was a torpedo going through the water. It's trails of bubbles coming behind it. And it is a new technique that came from Japan, and it's absolutely killing them.
I've never done it.
Yeah.
I never have.
I haven't had much luck on it. I never understood
it
that well.
I haven't done it with success.
Yeah.
real quick.
Yes.
If you're throwing it out there,
yes.
You're counting it down.
Correct.
And then you're just reeling it very slowly.
Almost like you're swimming a grub. Very similar, you know, swimming a grub. A slight, slow, steady, and keeping a rod tip low. And it's the lightest tick. It's almost like taking a grub. That's
Bobby,
all
Bobby, you're going to wreck him on that.
I might
That's
now.
All
now,
you.
Now
he's you, Bobby Bergren.
What time of the year do you think the spy bait comes into play the most?
You know,
our condition wise.
On St. Clair, obviously, it's coming in the summertime when the fish are post spawn through before the fall feeding starts. I've been trying it in very cold weather, you know, 45, 50 degree, and just trying to figure out exactly what depth they're at first and the countdown. You know, in the spring of the year, they want something suspended and sitting still, and this is a bait that can't do that. So I'm finding out it's more orientated post-spawn through summer into fall. That's when I find it the best time.
So when you find them early in the spring, you're throwing a jerk bait.
Yeah,
then at them instead.
Yes, I'm throwing a jerk bait.
Okay, okay. You guys got any more questions on the spin bait?
No.
I think he knacked it right on the head.
I want a spy bait someday.
Yeah, let's.
When
be
I grow up, I'm going to spy bait Jeff Miller.
Okay, that's fine.
We're waiting for that day.
Jeff, what else you got in here? Let's pull it out of the box here.
Okay.
Now you got some. I want to get right to the juice here.
Uh-oh.
Now this thing I have never thrown anything like this. Can you explain this?
That's the helicopter lure.
What the?
That's a trifecta.
I learned this a couple years ago and play with it more and more. And it's a drop shot, but I'm using a very small number 6 treble hook. And, you know, tie just like a drop shot like you normally do. And the weight will be underneath there. Instead of a single hook and a single bait, you know, because the A-rig craze. As many baits as possible, and it's in the summertime. It's a school of minnows, and it's unbelievable. It's by Fishero, and that particular drop shot bait is absolutely killer in the summertime.
That's a little minnow orgy right there.
That's exactly what it is, Pat.
That's a three way.
I love this.
Yes, they sit straight out. You know, when it's in the water, it's a drop shot, and you're using 3-ounce weight. The baits sit right out, and the tails, it's unbelievable.
And that's there's no regulation against that either, because a treble hook is considered one hook.
That's correct. That's the big thing.
Now, how is the hooking up with the treble hook on a drop shot rig?
It's pretty good.
You could lose a lot of fish on the lake in the summer when they're scrappy.
Correct. You know, the thing here at home, their mouths are super soft in the summertime.
Yeah.
And you know, a single hook on a drop shot actually works very successful. The treble is so small, you know, you're going with a number 6. I don't recommend number 4.
Number six. What any treble you recommend?
I really like I like Owners. I like Gamagatsu's, the top brand. The deal is the number 6. You go to number 4, it's killing the bait and it's too big and they're not getting in their mouth, especially the smallmouths. They almost get the whole treble hook or one gets caught on the one side and 90% of the time you're getting them in.
And what kind of weight are you using, son? Are you using a heavier weight to get it down?
Almost always 3/8.
3/8?
3/8 to 1/2 ounce in the summertime.
Okay, cool.
The only time I'm throwing quarters, usually in the spring.
Now, that's a nifty little rig. I never even thought about throwing
Dude,
something
we are
like
learning
that
today.
Drop shot.
You know, we're getting into more baits here. I tried crosstail shads and stuff. There's certain baits that work with that rig, and there's certain baits that don't work with that rig. The Fish Arrow works very, very well with that rig right there.
The Fish Arrow.
These are so these from Lee's, right?
Yes, it is. Lee's Global Tackle, yep. Lee hooks me up with the latest and greatest.
Why doesn't he give us that kind of stuff, John?
Well, John, are you listening? Give us some stuff.
He's getting me the evergreen chatterbait. He's getting me the evergreen chatterbait, right, John?
Paging John.
John, evergreen
John,
chatterbait.
Paging
evergreen.
John.
Now, you have another pack of these here, the 4 inches.
Now, that's I'm using a single hook.
Single hook?
Yeah.
All right.
Yep.
Now, talk to us a little bit about drop shotting on the south end. It comes into play.
It comes into play. You know, everybody thinks it comes into play during the spawn. Put it on their bed, a drop shot, and that's the time for it. What people don't realize is we throw it a lot when it's cold out, a lot in the spring, but the leader's got to be tremendously small. And I'm talking sometimes 3 inches. And as it warms up, I'll lengthen the leader.
Okay.
I might go to 6 inches, then 8 inches. And by summertime, either here at home or even on St. Clair, I've gone as long as 2 to 3 feet.
Okay.
It's pretty amazing. You got to look at your graph, find a fish if they're suspended in the rocks or in the holes here at home anyway, and adjust your leader accordingly. That's a number one.
Okay. Top three drop shot baits you throw. You say the Fish Arrow is one of them.
Crosstail shad for sure.
Stand by the crosstail shad.
Yep.
That's the thing you're going to talk about next. What colors do you like?
Anything watermelon like we were talking about earlier.
Now, this looks like a little perch right here.
Yeah, that is a perch. That's what in my eyes, that's a perch.
This one's actually called Purple Weenie, but it looks like a perch.
Phineas Jane, whoopee, you're the greatest.
Purple Weenie.
Gee,
we're giving up all of Jeff's secrets today.
It's here at home, I try to stay as basic as possible. Dale brought up earlier about alewives. I try to have something whitish that's going to represent a minnow or alewife or something. I try to have something that's going to resemble a perch because there's a tremendous amount of perch out here. And, of course, the goby, which either a light brown or a dark brown. And that's as simple as I go.
Cool.
I don't think we need to go, you know, I'm not crazy about the pinks and the bright purples here at home. I try to keep it basic with 3 or 4 different colors, and that's natural is what I really like.
What about combination purple, chartreuse, orange, brown, and flesh?
No.
No?
We're saving that for the minnow orgy.
the minnow right. orgy. Jeff Miller's Standards minnow orgy. Now, you got a few things left in here, Jeff.
Okay.
Now, I'm seeing some tube heads
yes.
here. Now, yep. tell us a little. Are these dem jigs?
These are dem jigs. It's
dem jigs. South Side. Yep. Not them jigs.
Dem. D-E-M jigs.
Dot com.
John DeMay. Yep. Yep. He's making a tube jig for me now. JJ's tube jig. As many baits as you see here, and I throw a variety of everything. I'm still old school, kind of throwing a tube a lot. Gets it or tube, and working with John on the right head for it, and it'll be out real soon.
Now, like awesome. Since a tube, the head goes inside the tube. Why are they painted?
John is painting them for different weights, so it's easy to identify. When you open up your tackle box, you have a lot of lead colors, and he wants to be able to identify what is your 3/16, your quarter, your 3/8 by the look of the color. That's what he wants to do. And it's, why ain't everybody doing this? I mean, when you open up your box, okay, I know, you know, the brown ones, I know for a fact they're quarter ounce. The green ones, oh, they're 3/16. Boom. I'm not looking at the lead and saying, oh,
right.
is this one a little heavier, so on and so forth. It's,
awesome.
It's genius.
Now, that's yep. an ingenious
why
idea.
Why hasn't anybody
Because I look into a box full of just straight lead and I
right.
can't find what's
I
going
do it
on.
With tungsten, too, with the bullet weights.
Exactly.
And I'm like, wait, is that a quarter or a 5/16 or a 3/8?
That's right.
You're wasting time,
That's
dude.
Exactly right.
Great yep. idea, John DeMay.
Yes, it is.
Great
idea. Yep.
Now, you got one last little thing here, and I know you didn't want to talk about this one. This is the Norray's frimp.
Yes.
Like, what is the deal behind the frimp here?
Okay, I don't drop shot that bait.
You mind if I open it up?
Open it up.
So tell us a little bit about it.
It's scent impregnated. If you look at the tail, it's very very thin, tiny tail that has tons of amount of action. And this bait also, I rig either wacky style like you do a Senko, or I rig it long ways.
So
if I take the hook.
Oh, my God.
Instead of going right
yeah,
through the egg
smells
sack.
Smells like Play-Doh.
Wow.
Right. Instead of going right through the egg sack and rigging it wacky style, what I'll do is I'll go lengthwise.
Okay.
This way. And as you can see, it just shakes like this all the way down as it's falling. It's a very, very slow faller. A lot of times I'll take a little piece of lead or a little piece of tungsten and stick it in
like
the nose.
A nail weight.
A nail weight.
Nico rigging it.
Nico rigging it sometimes. that's a big technique people ain't talking about too much either. And that makes the bait fall a little bit quicker.
Okay.
And makes the head, you know, dart down to the bottom. And this tail on this bait is absolutely crazy. Absolutely crazy little bait. And it's the last 3 or 4 years, a lot of guys here at home been throwing this and not talking about it.
So that's what you've been taking my money on.
This and some other stuff.
That's not coming out of the box, is it, Jeff?
That stayed at home.
And these are pretty hard to find. Where can you get them at?
Lee's Global Tackle has the best selection of them. It's he gets them in all the time, and the selection's fantastic.
Awesome. Well, that was in the box. I have one more special shout-out to Papa Bruce Bergren. Happy birthday. Thank you for putting all of Straight Cast together.
Oh, if it wasn't for Papa Bruce, man, there would be no Straight Cast, Bobby.
He just got the best perch rod the other day. I tried to get him to bring it in here, but he didn't want to be on the air.
I don't know what's wrong.
Anyways,
with him.
Happy birthday, Bruce. Thank
yes.
you very much.
Yes, and thank you, Papa Bruce. Straight Cast, outdoor cartoon television. Hey, you got to keep it locked because right now is our extended break. We actually get a chance to stretch and cast, and we're going to have a minnow orgy. So when we get back, it's the local hammer with Ryan Popcorn Whitacre. Don't you go nowhere.
Want some more exclusive JDM Tackle? Join JDMTackleMembersOnly.com. This is a brand new membership website that gives their members the exclusive rights to custom limited edition Japanese baits in colors that cannot be purchased anywhere else. Sign up now and you will receive 2 free Megabass Vision 110s in Kasumi Tiger and Smallmouth Bass. That's totally worth the membership. Go to JDMTackleMembersOnly.com today.
Zodius, designed to fish any technique 365 days a year. The torsional rigidity of High Power X construction allows for the most accurate of casts to where the giants live.
Chris, come here, dude. Get up in here. That right there is a good one.
A face full of salad and a mouth full of jig.
The lightweight yet powerful components that make up Zodius, High Power X Blank, CI4 plus Real Seed, and Alkanite guides let you cover the water.
Smoked it. Smoked it. Smoked a blade bait. Look at the power of these fish. Get up in here.
With a variety of finesse techniques that are very effective at catching fish. The sensitivity of High Power X construction and custom guide drain make the lightest bites the right bites.
There we go. God. Oh, that's a good one. Hammered that little jackal eye shad. What a beast. I love it.
The key to fishing crankbaits is to cover water, and the crisp action of High Power X allows the rod to flex without collapsing during a cast to let you launch the bait and get it in the strike zone.
Another one. Oh, dust it. Come here. Easy. Pretty good dude right there.
Spring, summer, autumn, or winter. Shimano Zodius. One rod, anytime, any place.
One man who was fishing in Louisiana, he thought that he caught a catfish. But boy, was he wrong.
I think we got a garfish, dude. Be careful, Evan. Oh my God! That's a big gator, buddy.
Oh!
Pedal.
You see those teeth come up?
Oh my gosh, that's on the line in a state park southeast of Lafayette. The fisherman says that he nearly had a heart attack. As would I.
I think we all did sitting here watching.
See you later, alligator.
Did we mention there's all, I think his 11-year-old daughter or son is behind him.
Oh, my goodness.
In
really?
The video, and oh, my
goodness. Looks like a jungle cruise at a theme park.
It does.
Oh, my God.
I would have been crying left and right if I was that little kid.
Oh, man.
Hey, here's your 7-day forecast mid
call for one man who was fishing.
Thank you.
How did you change your body? I mean, like, just really working out?
Mm-hmm.
Could you take...
I did martial arts a lot and full contact karate and weights. And...
Could anybody do that? Could you take these two here?
Yeah. It just takes determination, hard work, and an instructor.
The world is a vampire, sent to drain, secret destroyers, hold you up to the flames.
Despite all my rage, I am still just a bass in a cage. I'm an illegally planted bass in a cage that some scumbag tournament angler is going to come take out and weigh in at the end of the tournament.
That ain't very sporting.
No, have mercy on their soul. Have mercy on their soul. I'm Pat Renwick, Straight Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. We got an action-packed show. Still, lots of stuff left. Lots of stuff left, you know? We got the sprawling Midwest fishing report. We got your stalwarts. Stalwarts. The stalwarts are coming in. And right now it is time for Ryan with his lovely popcorn humps to come on right now.
That's about the right size.
With the hammer, we got a double dose of Jeff Miller. Yeah. That's Jeff Miller, man.
Yeah, Jeff, I got to apologize for this first 48 vibe, but we're going to cross-examine you here. Me and Bobby.
Read his file, dude. Read his file out loud.
But, Jeff, so you are the local hammer for good reason. You hammer him. I know it's an overused term, but that, I mean, there's no other way to put it. Now, looking at your resume, you've done really well, tournament-wise, over the years. And I can't help but see a striking similarity between a lot of these tournaments. Okay. Most of these places have a lot of brown fish.
Yes.
Now, is that your thing? Is that just where, because of where you're from, because you grew up fishing Lake Michigan, or is that just preference?
I'd have to say a little bit of preference.
Okay. Is this mic on?
Keep talking.
Yeah, I'd have to say a little bit is preference with smallmouths. I used to travel all over Gunnersville, Okeechobee, Kentucky Lake, Lake Champlain, fishing tournaments all over the place. And honestly, traveling to these spots that had largemouths in down south, I felt like I was a donator almost, competing against the guys that were fishing almost 10 months out of the year, such as Gunnersville and Kentucky Lake and Pickwick and so on and so forth. And I wouldn't be able to compete the way I wanted to. I fell in a knack of fishing Michigan, being sponsored by some people in Michigan, and fell in love with St. Clair, Lake St. Clair, Saginaw Bay, and Lake Erie. And just got really turned on by smallmouths, whether it was Lake Champlain or Sturgeon Bay. And when it started to develop here at home more and more, and there was some little bit of money involved in here, you know, fishing at home, I really have a desire to catch brown fish and just fish the Great Lakes. It's a natural lake. It's not being generated by a dam and right. Controlled by a dam. And
it's got current every day.
Every day, current. That's what generates the bite, and people don't realize that
much. A lot of people don't know about the current.
I've seen this lake absolutely drop 2 feet in a six-hour period.
Right.
Drop or raise 2 feet, and that's all change of wind.
Yeah, wind tides.
And that does a lot to the bite out here, which you got to pick up on, and you got to understand that and what the fish are doing. But it's a natural lake. It's not controlled by a dam. And the smallmouth is my style of fishing, very fast. Aggressive. I live by the old KVD rule. You know, I knew his brother really well, Randy, and 10-minute smallmouth. Give him 10 minutes. Sure, they might be there. They're on your graph. Mm-hmm. But if they're not biting, it's time to run and find one that will bite.
Find a group
that, yeah. Find it. And it's not saying I won't come back. I will come back and visit that pot of fish.
Mm-hmm.
It just might be an hour, might be 2 or 3 hours later. Eventually, hopefully in that 8 hour period of a tournament day, they're going to bite.
See, so most people say it's the fight with the fish. And you're saying more it's the behavior of the fish and the way you can pattern them.
Yeah, yeah.
And where they live.
Yeah, it's to me, I think that's easier. And I really like catching groups of fish rather than, and believe me, I like flipping like everybody else does. I mean, I like throwing a deep running crankbait for largemouths, all that kind of stuff. But when it comes to smallmouth, it's fast, it's aggressive. The fight is fantastic. We can all agree on that, whether it's a 2-pounder or a 4.
Yeah, they dig.
They dig. It's incredible. And flying out of the water is something else. But it's the pattern of finding a group or pot of fish and getting them rolling and activated, mm-hmm. and then loading the boat as fast as you can.
Right, right. And that's what's so great about them, yeah.
Absolutely.
I mean, when you find them, you pretty much know.
Yeah.
Within a couple casts, you're like, yeah,
this
okay,
is it.
My arm hurts. We found them.
This is it.
Yeah. And you know, we talked to Ross about this, too. Fish is the same tournaments we do. But I know you go up Sturgeon Bay a lot.
Yes.
And you also live down here. You fish here a lot.
Yes.
What do you think the big difference is between up there and here as far as producing the numbers of fish? Because, you know, a lot of people will tell you it's the flats and stuff like that up there. But we do have them on the south end. I mean, there are large areas where they could spawn. I don't understand it completely. I know there's more bays up there and whatnot, but
the bays
it
up
seems
there,
like we should have.
I think
more
it's
fish.
Getting better here. I really do. I don't think guys enough are using your electronics enough. Mm-hmm. Certain guys and getting away from the bank and getting away from seawalls and getting out of marinas when the spawn is over. Because if you took from Cal Harbor north, we'll just go to Navy Pier. There is so many shoals,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not talking the ones that are close to the filtration plant in Morgan Shoal and stuff. Even further out, there are so many shoals in that stretch of Illinois. It is mind-boggling.
Right.
And if guys learn to use electronics a little more and find the bait, they're going to find the smallmouths that are more or less untouched, and they're actually easier to catch than the ones on all the seawalls that everybody takes a number to go and catch.
Yeah,
they probably have
everything. Everything. Yeah. And you know, back to Sturgeon Bay, they do have the bays for spawning, which produces a tremendous amount of smallmouth. They have a tremendous amount of the right sand with the correct round boulders.
Okay.
It's something that, you know, we got man-made stones here, big boulders, which is probably not the best spawning habit stuff. A lot of our fish spawn in the marinas, as everybody knows. The stuff on the main lake when they're spawning, you're finding the boulders mixed with the sand. And that's what you got to look for out here. It's not everywhere, and that's why the fish are spawning in certain regions. And that's the biggest difference between here and Sturgeon Bay and something like St. Clair. The spawning season or the amount of spawn that can go in those places it's ungodly. But it's getting so much better here. I mean, if we looked at the weights from when I started, when Dale was covering us, geez, 15 years ago, I think, we ran out of the river. The winning weight was 13, 14 pounds. Consistently, 14 pounds was huge. And the next year, maybe, you know, somebody hit 15. Following year, somebody hit 16. Now, every spring event that we fish is 20 pounds.
Right.
If not a couple bags that are 20 pounds. Now, in the summertime, if you don't have 16 to 18 pounds, in the mm-hmm. summertime, you're not competing.
Right. I mean, look at the 2000 Classic.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nowhere close to that.
Nowhere close that? To that.
Well, Wu had like 12
right.
a day, 12,
right.
13 a day.
Right.
I mean, and they were restricted too. But
yeah.
I mean, it just the size wasn't there.
It's getting better.
And it's I think you know the gobies are they're
gobies
they're
are
really
fantastic.
Just chewing on those gobies.
Gobies are fantastic.
And I mean the food source is crazy. I mean you
crazy.
Gotta figure that's why I tell people. People are always asking like you know what do we what are they eating most of the time? It's like everything.
Everything perch.
You know?
Perch. If there's alewives out there, you know when they come in, the coho are coming in. They're eating those too. Gobies, obviously, I think is their number one food right now.
Yeah.
Of course, crayfish. We don't get to see that many crayfish out here, but believe me, they are out here because we see it in our live wells all the time, don't we?
They're loaded with.
They're
them.
Loaded. You open up your live well at the end of the day when you're cleaning out, and this is filled with crawfish, and that's what they're eating.
And that's what's so amazing about it too is that you know you go anywhere along the shoreline, you look down, you'll see a goby.
That's right.
Just look at the bottom long enough.
That's right.
And they're actually ignoring gobies sometimes
yeah.
and seeking out crawfish.
Absolutely. That's their number one. That's filet mignon to a smallmouth.
Right.
It is. It is a crawfish.
They're turning down a goby.
Absolutely.
You know, who does that?
Not me.
Who does that? But no, so these tournaments that are going out of here, you
yep.
know, there's a big question in my mind, and I think all of us that fish it, is why aren't we getting the boats? You know, What is it about? I mean, is it the, you think it's the waves? Do you think people are intimidated? What I mean, what is it? Because, like you said, you know, I think we had a tournament the other last year where it was like top four places were over 19 pounds.
Yeah,
I mean, who does want I mean, to come it, and catch
right.
this fish?
Illinois, Indiana, them are the best weights in the whole state. I, honest to God, you can go down southern Illinois and you can go over to the river over in Illinois and you can fish some stuff in Indiana. In not a place can compare as far as weight wise. You know, talking to Dale out on the break, this place can be very, very can be very scary at times. Mm-hmm. It takes one time out there where the waves kick up on you when you're not expecting it, and it puts fright in some people. It really and I don't blame them. The wind turns, you got to respect the lake, 100%. You got to know how to navigate a bass boat. You know, a lot of the bass boats are not all 21 footers. A lot of them are 18s and 19s. And with a 150, and you got to know how to run and navigate in big waves just in case.
And there's days when you get plenty of fog out there, too.
Plenty of fog, and you get calm days, and then the next thing you know, the wind picks up after a few hours, and you made a long run to one spot, and you got to make your way back. It's I really think guys are nervous. I think that's the number one thing. Number two, it's hard work.
Right.
None of us that get successful it comes easy. It is a lot of time on the water, bad weather, good weather, hot weather, and learning a smallmouth. If you want to compete against these guys that are out there a lot, 2 or 3 days a week, you got to spend the time out there. There's no substitute for hard work. That's in any kind of fishing.
And I think access is part of it, too, just that you got to run. I mean, often you're dumping in at Waterfront Pub and running all the way up or dumping in at Cal Harbor, which is its own fee cost and stuff and still making a run.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, I let think me tell some you of that is.
The $27 is well
there you go. Yep. There you go.
It's a lot of money.
A lot of money to launch. Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You can go out. I mean, there's been plenty of times I've taken guys out. They've caught their personal best smallmouth.
Yeah.
I would say there's at least 7-8 guys I've taken out that have caught their personal best smallmouth.
I agree 100% with that.
And they go to Canada every year.
They go to Canada every year, right.
And they caught their
and
best
And there's so
here,
many threes you know? To three and a halves out here. It's unbelievable.
Right. I mean, they're everywhere.
Yep.
And it's just like I tell a lot of guys, you know, a lot of the tournaments Bobby and I fished, I practiced from shore.
Okay.
A lot of the spots we fish, I go check them out from shore. So there is a lot of access. If you're somewhat creative and adventurous,
absolutely.
Get out there on foot and go find them.
Absolutely.
I mean, most of the stuff we fish.
It's out there. Yeah, you can see them from the bank. You can catch them in the bank. Absolutely.
You can see them. You can catch them. I mean, a lot of times I think I catch them better from the bank because I'm not fighting the waves. So.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Get out there and explore it.
I mean,
these
now back in the day, there used to be a bigger draw of the tournaments. What happened there?
You know, Bobby, that's a tough call. I remember we were around 15 to 18 boats at one time, and then I remember being in a tournament. Went out of 95th Street, and I said, Al, I was fishing team tournaments with Al. I said, I think we got somewhere. We had 37 boats going out of 95th Street.
Oh, wow. That's
and
a
I
great
said,
tournament.
Great tournament. Great tournament. I said, man, we finally got it. We finally got the boats we really want, and this is going to start to be fantastic. Maybe someday we're going to see 50 bass boats out here competing against each other. A lot of circuits came and went in that time. Circuits went out of the river. And, you know, Bobby, I really don't have an answer for that. It definitely does not have to do with money or payout. I don't want to sound funny here, but it seems like each tournament, it seemed like three or four teams seemed to be winning a lot or seemed to be in that one, two, and three category, and it was three or four teams. Even though you had 25 teams, every tournament seemed to be three or four teams that were constantly up at the top. Now, did that discourage guys? That's a possibility because, you know –
they didn't feel like donating.
That's what they're doing. But it's hard work. If you want to
put your time in,
you
got
to put your time. You want to be successful in anything in life, you got to work hard at it. That's what I'm a firm believer.
I have one other theory, and the four of you would be pretty good guys. I remember that tournament where he hit. I thought it was 35, but I mean, it was just ungodly.
It
was like something you didn't never expect to see on Lake Michigan. But I think at some point, the boat dealers were thinking that they had a brand fresh market and they were pushing a little bit better with trying to give guys deals on boats to get out if they were fishing Lake Michigan. And then at a certain point, it just I mean, that was the peak. I'm trying to, that's been a few years.
Oh, yeah.
That was like 15
years.
The economy went down. And I mean, some of it was, I think guys just found it easier to fish inland waters.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah.
It's expensive to fish Lake Michigan.
Without a doubt.
Sure is.
You add up your gas, gas and oil. And when you said Ramfee, $27 for Ramfee, $25 for Ramfee. It adds up real quick.
Right. And there are opportunities. You can buy a year pass.
Yep.
I think it's $200.
Yep.
If you want to launch in Chicago.
Yep.
Which is a much better deal. If you
absolutely.
Go a few times, you'll pay for that.
You guys can live in Indiana and launch for free.
Yeah. That's true also. Yeah, driving in.
Oh, we love our
miles.
State of Illinois.
But
we just love it.
But then you'd have to be in Indiana.
Illinois Blagojevich.
Yeah, that's the problem.
He's in jail.
Jeff, to anybody that is going to go out there that wants to go try it out, do you have any advice as far as navigating through waves, if you do get into some bigger 3, 4, 5 foot waves,
any advice on how to drive in them? I do not go out with a marine radio. I think that's
not go out without a marine radio.
Marine radio on the boat all the time,
right?
In case of emergency, and our cell phone might get wet or something, but it gives you the weather band, the radio, or the winds of what direction it is all the time. Never go out on a northeast wind if you're not experienced out there.
Mm-hmm.
Northeast wind where we live in this bottom corner is absolutely the worst. Our best wind is a southwest wind, but I've seen southwest winds at 30, 35, where you can get a mile off, and it's very rough.
Yeah.
1 mile off.
Right.
It's still the right direction, but it's blowing extremely hard.
Or even up in Chicago with those heavy winds.
And the funny thing is you come around Inland Steel and get a little further north, the wind sometimes is so much different around Navy Pier as it is compared to Indiana.
Well, you've got the buildings that are throwing the wind in different directions.
Yeah. Tremendous. And you really got to play it smart. Southwest wind is the best. South wind is good. East wind, you know it's blowing from Michigan, blowing on our side, and it's going to be lumpy.
If you're in Chicago, lumpy. Straight west is
lumpy.
What you want.
Yeah. I don't know.
Lumpy like popcorn, lovely popcorn pumps.
That's right. Lovely popcorn lumps.
Right.
Yeah, so I mean, if you want to go out there, so just take it slow.
Take it slow.
That's what you're saying.
Take it slow. Go with someone that's experienced. You know, don't go out there blind. Try to get someone that's been out there before, knowledgeable how to run some rougher conditions, and take it easy and take your time.
Right. Awesome. Okay, hey, thanks for coming on, Jeff.
No problem.
I really appreciate it. Two segments.
Jeff, any special shout-outs?
Shout-out to Lee's Global Tackle, them jigs.
What about your woman crush Wednesday?
My woman
what is
my wife?
It better be.
Hi, honey.
Hey, where
are you?
Oh, wait. Isaac,
people?
Isaac and Lisa shouted out to
you. Oh, yeah. Okay, thank you. Isaac and Lisa.
Where can people find out about you?
I just got on Facebook because I'm getting hammered by my sponsors that I really need to get my act together here. But Facebook would be Jeff Miller. Anywhere you want to text me, get in touch with Bobby or something, he'll give you my number. I'll answer
just
all the texts.
Just text Bobby.
Yeah, text Bobby.
We're going to give his number out on the air.
Now, I guess.
hey, Jeff Miller.
Yes.
Here on Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television, we have names for big fish. We have Slubber DeGullion. We have Choo Choo. We have Fatty Magoo. We have Snoogin. What's your name for the big fish?
Wow, I got a lot of them.
I know. Tell us. I heard one the other day at Lee's Global.
Which one did I use the other?
He called it a Tron.
Oh, that is the Tron.
Tron is one. Tron is probably one of my favorites.
Like Jeff Miller is the Tron Slayer. He is a hammer. Thank you so much, Jeff Miller.
Yeah, Jeffy.
For coming on.
I would clap, but my ball broke.
hey, keep it locked right here. More Straight Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. We have our Hogwarts section, the Hogwarts. Our stalwarts coming up next. Nick Langton, and Eric Stark. See you in a minute.
Slayer Reel Tuning is Chicagoland's number one reel tuning expert. Whether you need your reel tuned up, souped up, or basic maintenance, Ben Botcher, the Reel Slayer from SlayerReelTuning.com, has your reel needs covered.
Ben is the official reel tuner of Stray Casts, and he can customize your reel to your exact specifications, like new ball bearings, drag washers, clean reels, and the latest and greatest handles. When it comes to reels, go to the best and contact Ben, the Reel Slayer, and get your reel tuned to perfection and back in no time. Go to the website, SlayerReelTuning.com. That's SlayerReelTuning.com.
Welcome back to the Sock Hop. It's Rock and Roll High School right here, Stray Cast, Outdoor Cartoon Television. A little Ramones action right there, Ryan Whitaker.
Yeah.
I know you were digging it. I know you were digging it. Hey, I'm Pat Renwick. That's Ryan Whitaker. This is Dale Bowman. And it is time for our Hogwarts. It is time for our Hogwarts section right now. Our stalwarts. Dale, who you got in the house?
We got Eric.
How about this microphone thing? Oh, he's getting crazy again. Yeah. He's getting crazy, Eric and
there
Nick.
He goes.
We got in the Panthers fishing shirt. Well, they both have. The shirt would be Eric, who just waved, who is the coach and the founder and the guy who'd been trying to get it going for years at Glenbard North. And then next to him is the kid that kind of helped get it off the ground and gave the impetus, and that's Nick Langton, and now a senior and
senior captain
and about to fish your last we gotta figure out the mic.
Coach Stark, get closer to the microphone. Treat it as your iron suit.
You know what? Here, do what these guys laugh at me that I'm doing a
How's that?
There we go.
Look at that. Put your phones on, now you're all official.
Yeah. And you can scooch down some. Yeah, there you go.
Boom. Look how pro we are.
Boy, that's
you see how we did that? That's how you Stray Cast like, Outdoor Cartoon Television right there. Phew!
What I like, one of the reasons I wanted them in is that when we're in the eighth year now of the IHSA high school bass fishing, and we're still only at about one in every three high schools has a team. There, Nick and Eric kind of combined to help get Glenbard North off the track. And I found it a little surprising because Glenbard North, I would have been a school that I would have assumed would have been in from the beginning. There are people who fish at in those communities.
Right.
And it's near good fishing. Can you walk through what happened to get it going? Because both of you actually had a little piece in it to get it going.
Yeah, I can start. Well, I went to college with the athletic director over there.
At Glenbard North.
Yep. And so I was badgering him from the start. I work at the middle school that feeds into Glenbard North. And I was basketball coach, so we played basketball over there. And, you know, I was like, hey, you know, everybody's bass fishing. Why aren't we bass fishing? He's like, yeah, nobody here wants to bass fish, you know. So I said, are you sure? Because it's really cool. It's innovative. Yeah. We're the first state in the country, you know, like – It's coming. He's like, okay, you know. And then it just got shelved for about 3 years. And then Nick came in the picture as a sophomore-ish. When'd you start sending badgering emails?
Well, oh, that's a new segment, badgering emails.
Kevin Short said persistence, right?
Persistence.
Yeah. Yes. So basically, I think it was actually the second semester of freshman year. I had contacted Mrs. Cartwright, who is kind of in charge of all the activities. And, you know, it probably took, what, a year before we got in contact?
Yeah, I'd say.
Yeah, you know, my biggest problem was I couldn't find a person to, like, support me. You know, I needed, like, a teacher or something.
A coach.
Yeah,
somebody
coach.
Has to
basically
fill the coach's
yeah.
role or activity role.
Yeah.
Bass fishing fits a unique slot in high school because technically it doesn't fall under the sports or AD right. side. It falls under activities.
Activities and clubs.
Yeah. And right. sometimes some schools are the same person runs it, and some places they don't. So,
yeah, so finally, Mrs. Cartwright, who's in charge of the activities, hooked me up with Eric. And I think we really just started off fishing what we went to the DuPage River, right? And kind of just kicked it off. And
yeah.
We were both, you know, thinking the same mission. You know, I really got addicted to fishing after freshman year. But Eric, you know, he's been absolutely awesome with the support that he's given us. You know, like I said before, we just had a really good mission, and we had some really good support from the school once I got a sponsor who was Eric.
Yeah, once we got it going, you know, Nick was badgering and then kind of rounded up a couple of friends that thought they'd be interested in it too. And, you know, I had put the bug in the ear of the athletic director, and once he's got the emails started, you know, it kind of got around, and then the AD talked to Mrs. Cartwright, who's the clubs and sponsors director, and was like, I think I have a guy if we really want to do this. So then they approached me, and we got it going from there. This is our third year?
Yeah, this is third our year. Third year, yeah.
Haven't made it downstate yet. Did win our DVC championship last year, though, on Braidwood, so
awesome.
Off
nice.
To a decent start. Yeah.
One of the things that the other problem with doing a bass fishing club is you're fishing from a boat. And I know you had some help with that. Yeah. I think you supplied one boat.
I did. I supplied the first boat. Yep. I was in the market for a boat, and the timing came out pretty good. So I got the first boat. And then the first year, we had Steve Moy.
Steve Moy, yeah.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, Steve Moy.
He volunteered for us.
He was just here.
Well, yeah,
he
that's yeah, what yeah. I heard. Yeah.
He's
yeah,
a straight caster.
Yes, he is. And he got into it.
And then after that, Nick's uncle has a nice boat, yeah. too. So him and I have been our two boat captains for the last 2 years.
How many members do you guys have?
So right now we have four.
Okay.
I got Nick, and I got Nick's a senior. I got two juniors and a sophomore.
Yeah, it's basically perfect, though, because I know you can sub in a tournament in high school, but since we only have two a boat, it works out perfectly because we don't have to sub.
It's a fine line of, you know, if you fish a place like Braidwood or you go fish Clinton or something, you know, if you're trying to run people back and forth to the launch to sub, you're losing 20, 30 minutes of
sure.
fishing time. So you want to have enough kids because you want to keep your club going and you want to have teams representatives, but it's a fine line of not having too many kids and making sure you always have four because you can always enter two boats in yeah. most of our tournaments. So
it's really interesting. I talked to Eric the other day about this a little bit because some of the big schools, what I would consider the big schools in our area for bass fishing clubs like Zion Benton and Manuka, they have dozens of kids, and out of that dozen, there are more than eight who would actually have some legitimate.
Yeah, they're sticks.
Yes,
yeah,
they really yeah. are. They're real yeah. fish. Some schools, everybody knows there's two people,
yeah, right.
and then you kind of fill in with two more and might have a couple subs. The way is you run two kids in a boat at a time, and then you can bring up to two subs for each boat. So in essence, you can have eight fishermen at a tournament.
Right. And so when I first started the coaching gig, I wondered, am I going to have to run? If I got a lot yeah. of kids, am I going to have to run it like a golf team where we go and pre-fish on a Thursday and whoever catches some yep. shore fish, like, gets the spot in the boat? You know, that's a tough thing to do, you know? Like, hey, you gotta outfish Nick today. It's like wrestle-off, you know, or yes. whatever, you know? if you do that, you get the front yep. of the boat tomorrow or whatever.
I
so
like
we
that.
Haven't run into that yet, but at the same time,
there are schools that have to do that.
Absolutely. Yeah. I've talked to some coaches, you know, just getting their philosophy and how you need to do it. And I don't have to, thankfully, do that yet. But we're always looking to add people. Anybody out there watching?
Now, where did you get sent for sectionals this year?
We're back at Bussey, I'm pretty sure. I actually haven't seen the list, but
the list is out. It's been out about a week ago.
Has it? I think we'll be back at Bussey.
I'm pretty sure.
Bussey North. Because there's two sections
of
Bussey.
Yes, there's two sections.
We've fished Bussey North every time so far. Yep. It's tough.
Yes, it is. That is not one of the easiest. The hardest one right now in our area is Heidke, and I don't know why they don't change
tough.
That one.
Yeah.
And to me, what they should do is double up on Braidwood, put two sectionals on Braidwood, have one go out of the north and one out of the south, or have two come out of the south and just have, you know, two different weigh-in spots. But it could be managed, I think. But that's me. And my other dream is I would love to see a sectional go out at Lake Calumet. Or
Yeah, we were talking to Jeff about that, right? Yeah.
Yeah. It's great water there.
It is great water. I think they would have to – the safety is a concern, and I can understand that because, I mean, as Jeff was talking, that's real water. That's not well, play. That's not play.
If they cut off Lake Michigan too, it'd be fine.
You just got to watch for barges.
That would be the only danger.
For barges. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, if we're running to Braidwood and places like that, you know, Chabanaw or whatever, that's not any farther.
It gets nasty.
Right.
Right.
And Braidwood can be treacherous too.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yeah. Right.
Unbelievable.
I had one, I think it was the first or second year that they held a tournament out there. It got blown off for 2 or 3 days in a row.
Oh, yeah.
And LaSalle, they finally stopped holding one there, even though that's a pretty good fishery. But just because of the wind, we're blowing it off, and they would end up.
Right. Well, you get high school kids, and the coach usually runs the boat. But you know, if you got experienced fishermen, they can be up running the bow mount, you know, and stuff like that. And if it gets nasty out there like that for kids who are inexperienced, that's not safe for them.
No, and it's not enjoyable. It doesn't build the sport at all. Now, there's another side to the high school thing that I found really intriguing, and I think it's unique. I don't know of anybody else doing it in this way. I have 4 kids. I've run them through. They've all played soccer, so far they've all.
I've been there.
All
but I'm one. Doing that right now with the soccer thing.
So, and I mean, soccer summer camp. That's what they didn't play basketball, so I didn't have to run them around a basketball camp. But soccer camp.
You're a soccer dad.
I am a soccer dad.
Awesome.
And none of them are as good as
I. You don't have a minivan though.
Little known facts about Dale Bowman.
You do have a minivan.
Oh, you do?
We do have a minivan. Oh. Actually, it's an actual van. So. Oh, there you go. But now you came up with last summer. You started running, I think it's called the DuPage Fishing Academy.
That's the name that I settled on, yeah.
Yes, and it's actually like a sport camp would be run at the high school, and instead you run it out of the park district.
Yeah, all of Glenbard North's sports camps are run through the park district. And so, I said, you know, every cross country's got one, track, badminton, whatever. I said, well, I'm the bass fishing coach. Why can't we run a bass fishing camp? So,
awesome.
You know, the park district, it's in the brochure like all the other sports camps, and it's nice because then the insurance is covered just like it is for the other camps, which when you're taking middle school kids out around the lakes is always a concern. But
especially the Fox River.
Yeah, the Fox in the spring, you know, could be
hold
pretty
on,
hot.
Hold on, kid.
Yeah. Watch it.
That's so slippery.
Yeah, so that's that. You know, we decided to put it together. It kind of took a lot of thought because I didn't know the best format to run it because I'm diehard. Nick's diehard, but how many 11-year-olds are diehard? So I was, you know, toying with half days, a few hours, but I actually settled on the full day, 8 to 3 o'clock. Glenbard North lets us take the little mini sport buses, so I can take about 12 kids. You know, we just pond hopped. We fished the rivers. I talked a little bit about fishing subdivision lakes where I get in with some homeowners.
I want to go.
No,
let's get in, right?
There is, but you could be a guest.
We can team up.
You could be a guest. Yeah,
okay, I'm coming.
Guest.
Sign me up.
We got another place out in Bartlett, which is an outdoor outdoor education center. You know, it's pretty private. And we actually went there for some bluegill fishing, and they got some nice bluegills, and it turned into a catfish day. We were catching double-digit catfish, you know. So
wow.
Yeah, the format worked great. We pond hopped on the minibus. The kids pack a sack lunch, or they bring $5 and we drive through somewhere as we're going
through
going to the next spot, you know. So I had 8 kids last summer. Hopefully with word of mouth and the stuff we're talking about here, you know, I'd like to grow it to 3 full weeks of what we're doing.
I just love the idea. And once again, this is like the idea of high school bass fishing itself.
Right.
It just makes me sick that now this stuff comes when I'm an old man. So,
right.
I want to get back to the subdivision stuff because, to me, that is one of the neater things that you can teach.
Oh, we're
any
giving
kid.
Away all the secrets tonight, right? On the show.
Nice.
It's everyone's top secret
it's
tonight,
on that
right?
Street.
Yeah.
No, you don't need to say where it was, but I mean the whole idea of gaining access to fish a subdivision pond and doing it legitimately so you don't have to sneak into it.
Right.
Is a big deal.
Yeah, so for me, we got a couple that I was lucky enough to have students in class that actually live in those subdivisions, so I met people through parent-teacher conferences and things like that. So
I could love now, that. Now I see how does that conversation go?
So
say, Bob, don't you live on?
So that's kind of how it started. And then, you know, if you don't know people, then you actually have to randomly knock on a door. Or if you are showing up in somebody's backyard and they come out, you got to have a nice, polite conversation. Hey, I'm catch and release. I'm here. I'd like to bring my daughters out. You know, if you're taking kids, most of the people are on board with that stuff all the time. You know, as long as you're picking up when you leave and you're respecting their property and, you know, you talk to homeowners and they'll let you in there.
Yeah. And at the outdoor education center in the winter, usually we did it last winter. We help out and we run an ice fishing clinic for the kids. So I think it just comes down to being respectful and helping out, and it goes a long way.
I loved the photos that you had on Facebook is one of the best ways to get a hold of DuPage Fishing Academy. Is you had it lined up, and you were saying, I think, that nobody is on the ice, but you had it right next to the wall.
Yeah,
so
this year
it.
We had to run an ice fishing clinic with no one on the ice.
On the docks.
So,
because there was no winter.
Well, right. You know, the shorelines deteriorated quickly in about a four-day span. So we drilled holes all along the U-shaped dock, and we set tip-ups and automatic fishermen's along the whole thing. And, you know, set the vexes in the holes so the kids could come by and get a feel for
that.
Hey,
we caught some fish.
Yeah, we caught a few fish. Oh, it wasn't at an ideal spot, but when you can't put anybody on the ice, you're kind of...
You got to do what you got to do.
Yeah.
Nick, speaking of fish, what's the biggest one you've caught within either competition or practice so far?
I think my buddy and I, when we won our Braidwood DVC tournament last year, actually, the way we won that is we had three fish in the last 10 minutes of the tournament.
Wow.
Limited out.
Never stop trying.
Never give up.
No, never stop trying.
Never stop trying.
Never stop trying. Never stop trying.
Cold side.
Yeah,
cold
side. Oh, I was going to ask that. You were on
warm
the cold
side. Warm side. When was it? Late April last year. We were fishing the warm side. You know, we were just busting the bank. And carp went through, started spawning in the afternoon. So we had about 45 minutes left. And I told my uncle and my partner, Jesse, I said, guys, we got to go to the cold side and, you know, hope for a few giants. So actually on the last cast, my buddy Jesse stuck a 3-even.
Nice. Yeah, maybe 3-2.
3-2 maybe. And we beat, I think it was Wheaton, Warrenville South by like 6 ounces or something.
Now nice. And for those who don't know, Wheaton, Warrenville South is kind of the apex of DuPage Valley Conference.
Yeah, they're pretty good.
They made the tournament, I think, the state finals every year, but one or two. So
I want to say they got that Plano Award that they're doing for high school teams, too.
I think they did.
Yeah.
So, well, good. Thank you very much. And, Nick, do you think this is the year you're going to be downstate at Carlisle?
Yeah, I think we got a plan for Bussy. Hopefully my partner and I catch a couple fish at Bussy, and we're down to state.
Awesome. Nice.
Yeah. Wonderful. I appreciate your coming in.
Hey, thanks for having us.
Thank
we appreciate
you so much,
it.
Hey, Coach Ironman.
Yeah.
If they want to help out, how do they get a hold of you? If somebody wants to help as a boater, or how do they get a hold of you?
Yeah, so the Fishing Academy thing is on Facebook and Instagram, DuPage Fishing Academy. Dale's article today had my work email in there. It's starke@ccsd93.com.
Awesome.
Dale, that article was awesome, by the way.
Oh, thank you. I was glad to hear that you got Polaroid glasses.
I did. From Dale's article today, I already got somebody that is going to provide polarized glasses for the summer.
Wow. The magic of Stray Cast and the Viceroy of Bourbon.
That's right.
Right there. Nick Langton, what's the first rule of Bass Club? What's the first rule of Bass Club?
Always have fun.
Always talk about Bass Club.
Always talk about
Bass Club. Always talk about Bass Club. This is Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. Never stop trying. Thank you very much, guys, for coming on. It's a great thing that you're doing. Keep it locked, because when we get back, it's the sprawling Midwest Fishing Report. We're going to tell you how to catch fish. Maybe.
At Sleaze's Bait Shop, Rich the True Sleazak tells it like it is, honest with fishermen about the local fishing reports, weather conditions, and advice. He is a true region fisherman who has what you need to get from the shop to the water. Rich is always on site, and Sleaze's Angler's Outlet is a family-owned and operated. At Sleaze's Bait Shop, Rich the True Sleazak tells it like it is, honest with fishermen about the local fishing reports, weather conditions, and advice. He is a true region fisherman who has what you need to get from the shop to the water. Rich is always on site, and Sleaze's Bait Shop is always open. Just ring the buzzer by the door and Rich will fill your minnow bucket and not be stingy about it. Sleaze's also has a full selection of terminal fishing tackle. Look for Sleaze's Bait and Tackle on Facebook. Sleaze's Bait and Tackle has been family owned and operated for over 29 years and is located at 2245 Randolph Street, right off 8094 at the Ripley South exit and minutes away from the Big Lake. Angler's Outlet is a family-owned and operated tackle store. From panfish to muskie, the guys over at Angler's Outlet have what you need. Conveniently located 159th Street and I-57 at 16,300 South Cicero Avenue in Oak Forest, Illinois, Angler's Outlet has a full line of tackle from the best brands in the industry and a full selection of live bait for every type of fisherman. If they don't carry the item you are looking for, Brad Jackson, the head honcho at Angler's Outlet, will gladly order it for you. Angler's Outlet is here for the South Side and the region anglers.
I got three ships and 16 men. A chart for land unknown. Straycast outdoor cartoon television.
You got something all right.
Land ho! We are here with the fishing report. The
Straycast. Perch, soaring crucified.
Angler's Outlet.
Yes. It's the lament for Larry's perch. Hey, brought to you by Angler's Outlet. Go see Brad over at Angler's Outlet, and he's going to hook you up. They have the up to the second fishing report. We're giving you the fishing report once a week. You want to find out what's going on, go see Brad at Angler's Outlet. I'm Pat Renwick, Dale Bowman, Bobby Bergren, Ryan Popcorn Whitaker, and Jeff Miller joining us back for the free-for-all. Now it is a trifecta.
Yes. Uh-oh.
It's a trifecti. It's a trifecta.
Yes. No, it would be a penta.
A pentagram?
Natas.
It's a pentagram.
Natas.
I didn't
Sailor
say pandy.
Natas.
I said
Sailor Natas.
What the world is going on around here? Hey, a couple things first. Before we get into the fishing report, I want to remind you, USA Bassin. It's a tournament organization that started here in the area. It's been around for a long time, but it started running some tournaments here in the area last year. Eric Novotny is running the local deal here on Wolf Lake and Lake George. And I'm actually going to fish a tournament Sunday. I'm not a tournament guy anymore, but I'm going to fish a tournament. So come on out and take my money. Go to usabassin.com, usabassin.com. Sign up for the Lake George event. Come on out there and take my money. We'll even get side bets. We'll get it all going. We'll see what's going to happen. Fishing has been hit or miss. They're either hitting them or they're missing them. Wow, that was profound.
That's profound.
That was very profound. But you know,
the weather's been hit and miss too.
There's something that we always have to remember, that there are always fish to be caught. Somebody's going to catch them, and there's always a way to catch them. It's a matter of putting that together. Like, for example, what's this hot bait right here, Bobby B?
That's a Jackal TN60.
That's a Jackal TN60. That has been a killer on one of these local lakes. It's a mystery lake, but this has been a killer.
Those who know.
This has been a killer on Eric's spot. Yes, it has. Yes, it has.
Uh-oh. Ice spot.
Dale Bowman, tell us how to catch some fish, dude.
Well, the one thing that's going again, and especially as the lake clears up, and I think this will be a big-time weekend, is the brown trout and the coho have been in again. And on Saturday, Henry's had their big gathering at Navy Pier, and it was just a nasty day. If you remember it, it was snowing.
That
was
beautiful.
Like, yeah, it was 24 degrees, and the wind was slapping in there. I think it was 22 miles per hour, as Jeff very aptly noted. Northeast is not a friend if you're on the Chicago lakefront, but it was blowing the wind in, and it was ice. It was cold enough. It was icing up.
Crab fishermen hate it, too. Crab fishermen hate nor'easters.
Yeah, well, that's a different type.
That's a nor'easter, Dale. Yes. That's a nor'easter, Dale. Yes. Yes.
I'm distracted.
I saw that on the Learning Channel.
I did, and I saw it on the Deadliest Catch.
They get a little more extreme weather than we get. Although I've seen a couple November blows that are close. But the one thing they learned at the Henry's event was the slack water, because for this they were allowed to fish the southeast corner. If you got out of the wind and were fishing the slack water, they some of the power line guys caught limits in a couple hours. So, I mean, it's one of those little things. You pick up a little piece of knowledge. You get out of the wind. Fish ain't stupid either. They don't want to be beating the 5 and 10 footers or whatever was blowing that day. They wanted to get in the slack water,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, you get out there and you catapult 12 hooks out there.
Yes,
yeah, that's why they're catching them.
It's called winging the sabiki.
The hook and line guys caught them, too.
Okay.
Just a paw fish.
They didn't catch any limits, though. Yeah, there is an advantage. There is an advantage to bait and to doing many, many hooks in the water at one time.
Yeah. Skein on the bottom. That's what you need for coho.
Yes.
And skein in the membrane.
We should do a song like that.
In
skein
in the membrane.
The membrane.
I invented that. Thank you.
Have we ever recorded it?
No.
Or have you ever
recorded
it? He
did invent it.
I did invent that.
5 years ago.
Yes.
At Pastrick's Marina.
In skein. Got no brain. Dale.
Actually, I think I do remember you singing that on the old bass bus.
I did. And that was before I started saying, you got some fries with that shake booty.
You just want me to do that again. You're trying to
I want Jeff
my
Miller.
Tight
Jeff Miller, will you give me some fries with that shake booty?
Is that what it is?
Yeah, come on, do it.
Give me some fries with that shake booty.
That's that is how you stray cast right there. That was boring, right, Larry? That's why crickets are playing. I don't know what the hell's going on around here. Okay, back to the fishing report.
I want to talk bass.
Do you?
I think this will be the weekend. There will be a lot of people milling around and trying it.
Unfortunately, yes.
Yeah. actually, I was hoping you would say that
there.
And talk about it, Ryan.
Yeah, I mean, it's been going on. It's been going on since the beginning of March. They've been catchable. It's gonna explode here soon.
There's going to be people out.
Could be any time.
If you're going on a lake, what's one bait you're going to throw?
Bass.
I mean, don't make me say it, but it's true. It's true. What am I going to throw, Bobby?
You're just going to throw a tightrope jig.
What
That's
color?
Right. It's
what
a Ryan
color,
Popcorn
though?
Whitacre tightrope jig by Ryan.
I'm going to throw either black and brown or watermelon gold, depending on the water clarity. Most, you know.
It'll be fine unless
JP's catching them better on time.
I'm going to throw my cigarette butts.
JP just wanted to clarify, since Pat was calling the jig a finesse jig, that it's not a finesse jig. He put on YouTube that it's a super
jig. It's a super
JP's
jig.
My manager, right. So I will go.
Super
wait.
Jig.
Am I JP's
I
manager or is he my manager? I can't remember.
You are Brandon Polinick's manager.
That is true, yes. And Tom Billings is my manager.
Right.
I'm Jeff Miller's manager.
Oh,
yeah.
Boy.
And you manage his trolling motor.
Yes, I manage to get on the front of the boat every time somehow.
He'll steal it from me. You got
to
watch out.
But yeah, Dale, you're right. JP doesn't like to call it a finesse jig. And he's right, because most finesse jigs have a very light wire hook, and
we don't
do that.
Yep.
You bolt flip.
I don't care what
you're
you
right
guys
about
say.
Right.
It's a dang finesse jig.
It's a power finesse
it's a
jig.
Very okay, but it is finesse because it's like go. A piece of popcorn that catches
JP's
big fish.
Hey, words matter. I mean,
words hurt sometimes,
too.
Dale.
Oh, they
words
do.
Hurt.
Yes, they do.
Yeah, you're going out bass fishing on a local lake. What's one bait you're gonna throw?
Me?
Yeah, you.
Oh, jeez.
This weekend.
I mean, if I'm fishing some mud, dude, I'm gonna throw the hubcap at him.
What's the hubcap?
The hubcap. We heard Andy Morgan talk about it a couple weeks ago on the Bass Buzz segment here, and it's a big Colorado bladed spinnerbait, and it's just a cold, muddy water delicacy for the bass. Also, chatterbait, Also a flat side crankbait, maybe a you know, just like a good old PH custom lures in the little hunter type size right there.
The little hunter.
Yeah, look at that little hunter.
They call me the
Dale,
little hunter.
You're going out to the Kankakee. What are you gonna throw?
I would actually go to a pond and throw a Senko.
Senko?
Yeah, that would
cool.
be my. That would be mine.
I'm gonna go. Kankakee
is still a little dirty.
Let's go around the horn here.
Jeff, what are you gonna throw? Lake Michigan, one bait.
Tomorrow.
What's the water clarity? Pretty good?
Yeah, boy.
I don't know, man.
Versatile.
41 bait.
All right, but if it's what it is clean right now, by the way.
Yes.
I'm throwing a Mega Bass jerk bait.
Mega Bass jerk bait.
Is that right?
Yeah.
The deep 110 or the regular 110?
You know, that's a great question right
deep
there.
Deep 110.
Probably the plus one.
The plus one.
Yeah. It right now, because I know what water depth they're at right now, so it's going to be the plus one.
What color, what pound line, what rod?
right now, this time, yeah,
local
I'll
head.
Tell you everything. This time of year, they really like whitish.
Cool,
I won't
like
go
a
with
pearl white.
Yeah, pearl white. French pearl is pretty good right now. It's definitely going to be 8 or 10 pound test fluorocarbon, sunline.
Okay.
It's going to be a jerkbait rod by G. Loomis with a metanium reel.
Whoa. Hey,
813?
Now
here's
an important one. Will you be throwing the Mega Bass with Edo technology or without Edo technology?
I only throw with Edo technology.
Okay, good answer.
I like sashimi.
Good answer. Back to you, Dale.
Wait.
I got it. Okay.
We
got to
ask Bobby.
Oh, but yeah, Bobby.
Yes, Bobby.
Ask Quattro, what would you throw?
On Lake Michigan, he said the jerk bait, very good choice. He said the tightrope jig, also an excellent choice. I'm going to throw a grub.
Grubbler.
Oh.
5-inch Kalins.
Kicking
Bobby.
It back.
Clear Grubbler. Hologram. 1/8 ounce jig head. 8 pound fluoro.
Okay.
Back to basics. I like that.
Well, I throw 20 pound fluoro, square bills, and catch big smallmouth.
Yeah.
I would throw it on.
I suck at smallmouth.
7.6 rod. 25 series reel. Probably a G. Loomis NRX 902 with a Stratic CI4 Plus 2500. 10 pound braid. With an 8 pound fluorocarbon leader.
Are you going to have your mouth open or mouth closed?
I'm going to have my mouth open because I'm going to be screaming when I hook up.
Will you catch more fish on a 7.2 rod or a 7.3 rod?
I don't know. It depends on what you're trying to do with the apple.
Long pants or capris.
How are you rigging that grub?
I'm rigging it tail down.
Oh, so open hook, tail down.
Yeah, open hook, tail down.
All right.
1/8 ounce jig head.
All right. I want to make sure. That's crucial, by the way.
I don't like it tail up. It just doesn't work for
Whitaker's
me.
The only
we've
guy.
Tail goes up on Texas rig.
Tail
goes up on Texas rig. And that's
I do it on,
open
on a culprit or a power worm or something like that.
Yeah, if you're rigging, the tail goes up. But if you're taking a Kalin's grub and you're rigging it on a jig head, it's got to go tail down.
Thank you very much, Jeff Miller.
That's easy, Matt.
Ryan doesn't know what he's talking about.
Well, some
I mean, they bite it tail up.
Yeah, but they, you know I'll what? They bite it better the other way.
Hey, okay. We mentioning culprit worms. A buddy sent a picture. His first bass of the year came from Willis Slough, and he was throwing the old classic culprit worm.
Nice.
Don't even ask me why he still had him.
The old, in the moccasin color?
I don't know. He was not throwing moccasins.
Red shad?
Something a little brighter. I think it might have been red shad.
We call that pulling a baby.
Brian Kershaw.
Yeah, it's called
color.
The Winkler.
Yeah.
It's called the Winkleburger.
The other thing is, that treble hook with...
drop shotting?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I looked at that and I'm going, I throw that up on the chain. I'm not going to be catching bass. I'm going to be catching channel catfish with that thing.
Yeah.
Ooh. You got live
don't
bait
think?
On it?
Are you going to put pheromones
no,
on
I
it,
mean,
Dale?
Even if you put the... Because, I mean, on the chain, I've... catch a fair number of catfish on crankbaits, especially this time of the year.
Oh, yeah,
and
especially
into
May. This time. Yep.
Yeah.
And especially if you sprinkle them with Bowman pheromones.
Oh, yeah. The best.
Yeah. I mean, that's a surefire method.
Absolutely.
Surefire.
You think I could sell that?
Yeah, Bowman's pheromones in a bottle.
De Limones.
Yeah.
Oh, I
Bowmones.
Like that.
Bowmones.
How do you make a Bowmone?
Well, that sounds
I
like
kick him in the knee.
You don't pay him. <You've got
laughs> Hey, you guys want to play some trivia?
Yes.
Yeah.
I got a trivia
Larry,
question.
Larry, now is the time where you would play trivia music.
Yes. Yes.
Larry. Gosh, for crying out loud. Jeff, tell him
why
what
to do.
Why
don't you come on over here?
I show me the button.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
All right. I
He's
did a
got
little
a
research.
For you.
I did a little research on this because I was curious.
I didn't know.
Are the listeners calling in to do this?
Yeah, can we do that? 219-228.
I'll give away some jigs if somebody nails this one.
Let's not hurt ourselves here.
Slow down. Let's try it. 219-228-1492. 219-228-1492. 1492.
Columbus sailed.
I will just say this is a question. Blue.
If you know the answer to this, Ryan's going to give away some tightrope jigs.
It's a compliments bass tournament to JP. History. Bass fishing tournament history question.
Nobody's going to get this. Nobody's going to get it.
I think somebody will.
Can I text my wife the answer so she can get the jigs?
Wow.
Well, I guess they could answer on YouTube.
Kyle Selgin is ineligible.
Do we have a caller?
No.
You got to give the question. What are you doing?
That's the question, for Christ's sake.
You watch talk radio. What's wrong with
this?
Here's
the question.
Okay. Oh, they got it wrong. Okay, well, next segment. Thank you.
I'm gonna ask the question now. You guys ready?
Okay, good job.
B.
That's a Cubs fan for you.
Yeah. B.
All right. There's only five of these. Who are Stooges. The five? Okay.
Marx Brothers.
You want to ask the question, Larry?
No, go right ahead.
Who are the five pro bass anglers to win both the FLW Forestwood Cup and Bassmaster Classic?
Wow.
There's only five of them.
So the Bassmaster.
Which, I say only. That seems like a lot, actually.
That seems like more than I would have guessed.
Only five anglers to win the Bassmaster Classic and the Forestwood Cup.
That's correct.
I think I know two.
Okay.
I think you do, too.
Are you writing it down, Jeff Miller?
Yeah.
Do you know this? Because if you do, you are certified.
You just got to give me a few minutes.
Because I'm a Bass Rain man, and I didn't get it.
I used to...
counting lures.
How many jigs in a bag? 228?
1,300 feet.
Yeah, give the number.
219-228-1492. Call up and take a guess, even
Columbus
if you don't
the ocean
Crank
blue.
Call us. We don't care.
He sat on the grass and...
I think we stomped everyone. Even
Nobody
Jeff,
knows that.
Even Jeff is scratching.
I'm scratching. I'm just going through the past classics. So,
like all 50 of them?
Yeah.
He's going back to 1974.
He's a number cruncher.
You, sir.
Do you want one answer right now?
Yeah, go ahead.
Dion Hibden.
Yeah, good job.
That's 100%. One of them.
Good job.
Is Davey Height one of them?
Good job.
I got Davey Height and Dion Hibden down. No, just give me a few minutes
That's
here.
Two.
Give me a minute.
We already gave two.
All right, so you
got
a head
they
start.
They still have three left. Yeah,
I take Luke Clausen?
Are those calls
I'd like
are rolling
Luke Clausen
in.
For 500, please.
Are we going to give them all away?
No, we got three.
Oh, there's still two more.
Yeah, two more.
Okay. Yes, Luke Clausen.
So Jeff gets some jigs, Dale gets some jigs.
And I get more.
Right.
Thanks,
did Rick,
JP. Thank
did
you,
Rick
JP.
Did Rick Klun ever
Thank
win
you.
The FLW?
No.
Nope. He never won the
nope.
Cup.
Nope. Never won the Cup.
He did not. He won that classic. He won the classic.
No, he won
the last
four.
Two will be
yeah.
a challenge.
Yeah.
Kevin
sure
ever
did.
Won it?
No.
I don't think he ever fished it.
Oh, yeah. He was angler of the year in FLW.
Yeah, he absolutely
really?
Yeah. was. Yep. Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah. He wrecked him in the
I'm
FLW.
I'm learning things here, too.
Yeah. I mean, he wrecked him.
Remember him on Okeechobee, dude?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
I remember him on St. Clair. It was just amazing.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Did Boyd ever win a classic?
No.
No.
Oh, he won a classic.
He won a classic.
Yeah,
a classic. Never
classic.
Won FLW.
But he never won
never, FLW. Never FLW.
Phone lines are still open.
Oh, oh! Somebody, JP just got, JP, now we already said Luke
Clausen. I said
Clausen.
Luke
Clausen. Yeah.
JP, I said Luke Clausen.
Oh, JP.
Cheater.
Just give me
cheater.
He must be a slow typer.
JP should know this one.
He knows it.
He had Luke Clausen, but until he typed it in, it was too late.
JP, call us up, 219-228-1492. We'd love to talk to you. Come on. We know you're there.
Who do we got?
Actually, JP is
going to
be the guinea pig.
Yeah, he's the. We'll see if this phone line even works.
JP, be our guinea pig.
That could be the problem, that our phone line don't even work. That's how professional we are.
Show's over at 11, Pat.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus Christ. It's way past my
late
bedtime.
Night edition.
I got to clean my sock drawer still tonight.
Hell, Matlock's
give me a
still
going
to come on.
What year are the
two
other two in?
Girls.
What year? Do you know? Got any idea what kind
she
of year?
Some big ones.
Yes, she does.
Sorry.
So we got
they're
Hibden, Clausen.
Yeah, I think I could.
All right.
I think I could narrow down a decade.
Okay, go ahead. Decade. Go ahead.
I want to say 80s.
80s.
I got to think.
Not Jay Ellis.
Well, that's.
Got it. Jay Ellis is one of them. That's one.
No.
What do you mean no?
Wait.
No.
There's six.
Oh,
Jay
Ellis.
Jay
Ellis.
Wait a minute.
I won the bonus jigs.
No, Jay Ellis might not have won the
FLW. I don't think he
won
the cup.
He won the classic.
He did not win
the
cup.
He did not win the cup.
Lay Lake, he won.
Yeah.
Is Kanye one of them?
Kanye is one of them.
Kanye West.
Yes.
You almost got me there, but no Jay.
How about R. Kelly?
Oh,
FLW.
Wait, JP's busting bad on me. He says I'm slow at reading.
Me no read so good.
You're talking FLW championship, not Redman All-American, right?
Me go bed now.
No.
Okay.
Forrest Wood
That's
Cup.
The wild
Forrest
card.
Yes. Yes.
I'm stumped. Come on. Go ahead.
I mean, okay, when I say 80s, though, I mean their classic time.
Eyelids are okay. getting
because
heavier.
The Forrest Wood Cup didn't later. Start until
Absolutely.
96.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
We got Hibden, Clausen.
And Davey Height.
And Davey Height.
Great. Yep. Woo Daves?
Nope.
I just wanted to say Woo Daves.
You just love Chicago. To say Woo Daves. Yeah, that's all. Larry's breathing problem is acting up.
I'll give you a gigantic hint.
Yes, please do.
On one of them.
What state is he from?
Just give us the other hint.
I can't give you that one.
Give us the other hint.
He lives in a house with a
it's
roof.
Too big, but Neil and Real.
Oh, Paul Elias.
No.
That's Paul.
The other one.
Oh,
David Fritz.
David
Fritz won it.
You said it's too big. Cause like.
Yep, David Fritz won it.
David Fritz is one.
Yep. David Fritz.
Yep. And the other one.
Oh, wait. Aaron Martins.
Nope.
Al Lindner.
Nope.
Jerry Hunflerberger.
George Michaels.
Bill Dance.
Hello,
I'll
everybody.
I'll give you another hint.
I'm Bill
Bobby
Dance.
Just said
Hello,
the first
everybody.
Name.
Bill.
Bobby just said the first name.
Jimmy Houston.
Like 10 seconds ago.
It wasn't Jimmy. What was
you
it,
say?
Darth Vader.
See, they weren't listening to you.
George.
That was just a test.
George Cochran.
There you go.
You got it.
I said
That's
Cochran.
It. You got it.
Cochran.
That's it.
Very good.
George. Yeah.
George Cochran.
Cochran.
There they are.
I nailed it.
Cochran.
George is retired.
Yes.
He was. He was one of the people that I thought might do well at the Classic when it was here.
Yeah. But they made him retire because he was fibbing about using the Strike King Wild Shiner when he was really using a what was it? What's the not
he was
lucky
using
craft.
He was throwing lucky craft.
He was throwing a lucky craft.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Uh-huh.
That was on Gunnersville.
They nailed him.
Yeah. They made him retire for that?
Yeah. No,
yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, hold on. We have an incoming call. Let's see what happens.
In fact, Ray
oh,
Scott
they already
beat
heard
him
it.
Up.
Yeah. Hello, caller. Are you there?
Yeah.
Yeah, who is this?
This is JP.
Hi,
oh,
JP.
That's my dude. That's JP,
What's
man.
Up,
what up, bro?
Well, you already answered, and we already answered all the questions. So here's a new trivia question. Are you ready? Who did Larry the producer take a whiz next to at the Chicago Outdoors show 20 years ago?
Oh, Dale Bowman.
No, it was not Dale Bowman.
That's correct.
No. That was purely a men's stall meeting.
No, that was earlier today.
Come on, keep going. Pro fisherman. Here we go. Come on.
I like that answer, though.
What are you doing right now, JP? How's Senko? Senko is his cat, by the way.
I'm babysitting, so I got to kind of talk. Soft,
yeah, don't wake up the kids. Say
you're
things like,
your cat?
Have you checked the children? Have you checked the children, JP?
No, it's
my God,
my
he's in the house.
It's in the house. He's in the house. Well, they let JP in.
JP, since we were asking who's throwing what are you throwing tomorrow at Lake Michigan?
And be honest. Well, it's obvious.
Is it obvious?
The hubcap.
Yeah. A super jig.
Are you throwing a finesse
or
jig or a super jig?
More Kitech.
That's right.
Another good choice.
There's another good choice. I can't believe that didn't come out earlier. Right?
The Kitecher.
Yeah.
Kitechual seduction,
it
we
is.
Call it.
Bobby invented that.
Yeah.
Or did you invent that?
Let's leave your orientation
Bobby invented
out of this.
It. Trademark. Trademarked right there.
That's a Bobby. Hey, yeah.
Was okay. Larry Nixon one of the anglers?
No, he wasn't, but no. I thought
Ooh,
that
that's
too.
A good guess.
I said that to Ryan earlier.
Nor was he the one I threw a whiz
I
next
thought he
to.
Won a cup.
Never won a cup.
No, hey, I'll give you the list.
Hey, JP,
list.
JP, real quick, you know what's really bad? Is Ryan gave me all the answers earlier, and I still couldn't remember them. that's the bad part about it.
I did. That's right. I
yeah.
gave it to you on the phone.
I still couldn't remember. I didn't know.
So here's the list, JP. Luke Clausen, Dion Hibden, Davey Height, George Cochran, David Fritz.
And Orlando Wilson.
And Kanye West.
Now that I'm watching, Dale is not slow at reading. I'm like on a delay.
Yes, there is
a delay coming from the studio.
Yeah. We got about a minute.
Yeah, thank you. So you're that was kind of an apology for slandering me?
So, yeah, I'm sorry, Dale. You're the vice president.
Oh, I touch.
JP, what is your definition of a stalwart?
I touch you.
Oh. I mean, that's where you go and you learn wizard tricks.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely. You
from
are
a
absolutely
from a dirty
right.
Dirty wizard.
From Harry Pothead. He's the famous Harry Pothead that works at Stalwart. That's him.
Yeah, with Gandalf.
Yes, Gandalf the Bone Smuggler.
Dumbledore.
That's Gandalf the Bone Smuggler. We all know him. We all know him. All right, JP, you are the dude, man. Thank you very much for testing our phone lines, because apparently they do work. Nobody just wanted to call us.
Yeah, it was exciting. Yeah.
Okay, don't let it keep you up on that,
that's
JP.
Co-creator of the tightrope finesse jig. Dale, any more fishing reports?
No, we're done. Let's wrap this boat up.
Have we wrapped this up? Hey, thank you very much, all the sponsors, for making this show happen. Thank you very much to Papa Bruce, especially the birthday boy. Thank you to Jeff Miller for coming in.
Yes.
To Coach Iron Man, to Nick Langdon, to the one and only K-Pink, Kevin Short. And remember, now is the time. Let's go out and catch some fish, because this weekend, the Wrecking Ball with Miley Cyrus is going to happen in most of the lakes. Hey, Grandpa Paul, thanks for sharing the gift of fishing. Pat Renwick for Straycast Outdoor Cartoon Television. We will catch you next Wednesday, same time, 7 p.m. Thank you. Shut up.